Monday Night Raw results last night. It's 2015.
Really? You're already next year, huh?
I went into next year last night during Raw. I forgot that it was 2014. But here we are. We are live for the next 2 hours talking pro wrestling. God, the background has been fixed tonight. No air.
I wasn't having it this week. I said, we got to fix the goddamn little white spaces that are all over there. I don't like it.
Yeah?
It's unprofessional. Well, we're both blocking the logo, so we kind of gotta,
go over this way a little bit.
But, you know, they can tell that you can't believe this shit if you look right in the middle there. But,
looks better this week, doesn't it? Looks better.
I'm feeling good this week. We got our archive back this week. Mr.
Yes.
Daniel Humphrey, do you feel like ashes on my floor just now? What was that?
I've got a garbage can right here.
Oh.
I've got a can.
A plastic bag. Why don't you use an ashtray?
I forgot to bring it in here. That's why I got up and I,
there's an empty can over there. Why don't you use that?
Well, I may have to. I was going to pound a beer real quick and then use that.
There you go.
So. Anyways, but, so, an archive,
this week,
an archive is back this week.
Yeah, Daniel Humphreys is back. He emailed me. He was away on vacation for 2 weeks. He's back. It's funny how many people are on vacation. Shalik's on vacation. Andy Ravens is on vacation.
Right?
Humphreys is on vacation. These two guys right here, we don't take vacations.
No vacation.
Every week we're here. Every day we're there.
No vacation.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Got a new hat there? What is that?
Got a new hat. My father was
got
in town.
Got a new TV in there?
Got a brand new TV.
Got a new Wi-Fi right here.
Got Wi-Fi, right?
All right.
Listen, I came on here for the last couple of weeks. I've been saying we need to get the Wi-Fi fixed so that we can come on here and we can have the chat room up on this computer.
Rapid fire.
We can do the rapid fire every week. We got to get this stuff sorted out. So
they hate it when we don't do rapid fire.
They can't stand it.
They hate it.
We do the feedback, the feedback post that we do every week after we go up.
That's the same comment I get every time. Whoa, it was a great show, except for
blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
So anyways, for the past couple of weeks, I've been saying, Father's coming in, flying in from Colorado. We are going to hook up Wi-Fi. So.
She noticed.
Oh, yeah?
Something new different about Ryan. New hat. Miss Teresa says.
Yeah, new hat. But, no, so Father came in and he bought me like a 40-inch TV.
It's a nice TV.
In there. It's a beauty. It's a flat-screen TV. It's got the high definition. And then I went out and I got a new Time Warner cable box.
Yeah,
we got to
get me one still.
It's, yes. Yes, we do. Yes.
I want to watch the UFC on FS1. I want
to
watch that.
We need to get you a flat-screen, too.
I don't need that. I'm not high maintenance. I don't watch TV ever either. It's usually here. But
you got to understand, though, that you've got a box TV, right? We've got it under the table here. We can't bring it out.
So what?
That doesn't have high def capabilities. Even though the Time Warner box is going to have high def, that's like a 1990s television. Okay,
as long as I can access Fox Sports 1, that's not an HD channel, so I can access the channel.
So you don't need the high def. You just want to access.
I just want to access that one channel is why I want a cable box.
Okay,
because they run UFC shit damn near every every day.
Right.
But like half of the day, like Fox Sports 1 is basically 50% the UFC channel. Because they got that, NASCAR, some college football, and, some other bullshit in between. News shows like SportsCenter wannabes.
Right.
That's
right.
Really it. But, if I had that channel, I would have my TV on. Like, this guy's always got, I hear him, this guy's always got, we won't hear him with the air conditioner. Right. This guy's always got SportsCenter on in his room. 24/7, you go, except for the morning, he watches, like, morning news and shit.
I watch the Today Show. Not the Today Show. I watch Good Morning America in the morning. Good Morning America, GMA's on from 7 to 9.
Watches Kathy Lee Gifford in that. What's that bitch, Hoda?
Yo, listen.
I always fuck with him. There's that, and I'll come in every once in a while, and I'll see him watching, like, a soap opera, and he'll be like, oh, I just didn't change the channel.
Man.
Which is true, by the way, but I always say, sure.
Yeah,
wait a minute.
All right, every morning. All right, for people that follow the news, and you guys are up early in the morning, right? From 7 to 9 a.m. is Good Morning America, which is on ABC, right?
This
so I watch. I know.
He's like he's being murdered right now.
I know. He's crazy. Right? So he gets. So I watch Good Morning America from 7 a.m. to 9. Normally I wake up about 8 o'clock, right? So I miss the.
Is Good Morning America Matt Lauer and?
No, that's the Today Show.
Okay. You watch WCW instead of WWE.
No,
morning show.
No, you know what? Listen, here's the
Matt Lauer's wrong.
Matt Lauer and the Today Show used to be number one in the ratings for years and years and years. Right? In the last 2 years, Good Morning America has taken over.
Give me the names of people on Good Morning America.
The host of GMA are George Stephanopoulos.
GMA. I've heard that name.
George Stephanopoulos.
Yeah.
Robin Roberts.
Haven't heard that name.
Lara Spencer.
Haven't heard that name.
And the
Stoffagophagus, I've heard of.
Oh, God, what's her name?
Although I might be thinking of Fluffaluffagus or something like that.
But I watch Good Morning America, right? Oh. And then when that goes off the air at 9 a.m., a show called The Doctors comes on. That's when I turn it over to NBC, and the Today Show runs from 7 a.m. until 11 a.m. So I switch over to NBC.
They do a four-hour show? Mute that real quick.
No, they...
You said 7 a.m. to 11 a.m.
Yeah, the Today Show goes from 7 a.m. until 11 a.m.
It's a four-hour show.
It's a two-hour show, which is the main Today Show,
and then they
do Today Live, and then they do Kathy Lee and Hoda. And I have that on. And then Access Hollywood comes on.
Is there anyone more
annoying
than Kathy Lee Gifford?
I can't stand her.
I hate that broad.
I cannot stand her.
I don't like, and it's not just because I'm a diehard Howard Stern fan and he don't like her.
Right.
He has a long-standing rivalry with her. Although she did appear on his birthday
but
bash.
But they got
to watch the birthday bash of Stern?
Do you know that Kathy Lee Gifford has the same birthday as I do?
Yes.
Yeah.
And Madonna.
Yeah. And the day that Elvis Presley died.
I know you said
August
Elvis.
August
16th. Yeah, okay. Me and Kevin Nash share a birthday. So that's my big claim to
say. So anyways, but that's and then I watch Access Hollywood after that on NBC. And then in the afternoon, I put it on SportsCenter most of the time. So anyways, that's my TV schedule. And by the way, it's on kind of in my right ear as I'm working on the computer throughout the day. You know what I mean? But
anyways,
this is what we're going to do tonight.
What are
we
doing?
We're going to get the plugs out of the way. Then we promised these guys. We promised them last week that...
I was pretty drunk
last week. That when we came on here this Tuesday night, right now,
we argued
we
like little
promised
kids last week.
We did argue
the whole
like
fucking
kids,
show,
right?
Yeah.
And we can get into that again tonight.
I'm sure they loved it.
Not as long. We won't get into.
I know
as
when
long.
I listen to Stern and there's two people bitching at each other and it sounds so childish and immature.
Right.
I'm entertained like a motherfucker.
Yeah.
So as much as it's uncomfortable for us and blah 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 blah
people
blah,
love it though.
I'm sure they're like, listen to these two douchebags arguing.
Sometimes they bitch.
Arguments
that we go,
are always fun.
Sometimes they bitch that we go a little bit too long. Like, all right, enough is enough is enough. All right, move on to the next
well,
thing.
That,
you know what I mean? But let me say something.
Go ahead.
I forgot what I was going
to
say.
No, I was going to say, it's not that they don't seem to so much bitch about the arguments. It's just a matter of we don't get... They like the interactive stuff. They like the calls, the rapid fire. They don't like the Raw rundown. But then if we don't do Raw, it's like, well, you guys didn't even get the Raw.
Right.
But if we do Raw, it's like, why'd you spend so much time on Raw? You can't win.
You can't win with something.
So you kind of got to, as much as we say, give us feedback and we'll do this if you like it, this if you don't. It depends on who you want to listen to because half the people say do this, the other people say don't do this.
You can't,
it's like, well, which one should I?
You can't win with wrestling fans in general where they're always going to the dirt sheets are always wrong. They never get anything right. They're always wrong. But the stories that we do get right, there's no, wow, you got that one right. But the first one that we miss or the first one that we're off on, you got it wrong. You were wrong again.
Yeah.
You were wrong again.
It's like me with my boss. If I have one bad day out of 60, I'm damn near fired.
You're damn near fired.
But if I have 59 great days, I don't hear a fucking word.
Did you learn that over the weekend?
Today, yes.
Were you almost fired over the weekend?
Yes, I was. But and it was for a miscommunication.
It's
not like I didn't work. I did more work on something that didn't... I can't mention that sentence here, but I did more work on a site that he thought... It's hard to explain, but no, it wasn't a matter of I didn't work or I was lazy. I just did all my energy in the site that he felt was like second string. You know, although he said second string numbers were down, get them up. And
so check it out. This is what we're going to do tonight. We promised these people, and I know we were a little bit short-faced last week, right? These people that we were going to come on here this week, and we haven't done rapid fire in the last couple of weeks because we've had no Wi-Fi
we
can't do it. So, in hour numero dos, the entire hour, just like I promised you guys last week, hour number two is going to be live phone calls and rapid fire. So we'll put the thing up on Facebook, the place where you can submit questions on Facebook during the break. And then hour number two is all about you guys. We won't rush through the questions. It's supposed to be rapid fire, but we'll spend a little bit of time on each and every one of your guys' questions. So during the break, you submit them, and then we'll come back in hour two and just run them down, take a live phone call, kind of mix it up a little bit with rapid fire and,
interactive hour two.
And your live phone calls.
Yes.
Right. Hour numero uno, we are going to run down Monday Night Raw from last night, do the high points, low points, things like that. And just kind of talk news and rumors over the past
week.
Kind of a quiet week.
Yeah, there's no pay-per-views to cover. There was no wrestling pay-per-views to cover. There was two UFC events. but I could cover it. Watch, 30 seconds. Michael Bisping beat Kung Lee by fourth round TKO.
Not bad, too, right?
Rafael Dos Anjos, they say. It's Dos Anjos. Beat Benson Henderson. Big upset. First round, I believe, TKO, although it was a quick stop.
Well, Benson lost to... Benson lost.
Yeah, that's what Benson I said. Dos Anjos beat him. Okay. First round TKO, but there was a quick stoppage.
Right.
But a just stoppage, if you watch it. He was... The lights went out for a second.
Yeah.
And a good referee. The second they see your lights go out... They don't wait for them to come back on, and like, are they going to come back on in time?
Right.
Because if you let a guy's lights go out and they start doing this, then you're looking at brain damage.
Right.
So
right.
Second they see your eyes, and that's what they focus on when a big shot's landing. If they see your eyes go nine night land,
yeah,
they start running in. And even if by the time you run in, you're recovered,
mm-hmm.
too late. They see your eyes, boom, we're in there.
Yeah.
You got
something
fucked up.
I don't know how to turn the volume down. That's what I'm trying to
here.
Do. You know what I mean?
You do. You already got it muted.
Oh, is it muted?
Yeah.
Perfect. All right, we're good to go then.
Those were the main events. There was Tyron Woodley knocked out Dong-Hoon Kim.
Talk about Aldo and Mendes.
I'm going to get there. And then the Bisping Lee thing. So, and what was the co on Mike Pyle?
Yes.
Knocked out Jordan, or no, Jordan Mean knocked out Mike Pyle at the Benson Henderson show.
Jordan Mean's father.
And his father got arrested for sexual assault.
Right before the fight.
You look at War Machine.
Yeah.
Josh Crispy.
It's crazy.
Now Jordan Mean's father, Lee Mean.
Yeah.
All these guys, sexual assault in 3 weeks. There's been three, and they're major cases.
Do you know that TMZ Sports had a porn star come out today and say that, you know, War Machine tried to get into porn. He was at a party.
Yeah.
And I guess...
Famously commented on that.
I guess he was at a party and just assaulted numerous people. He was... You know, he seems like a real tough guy where he walks into the party.
Do you know the name
he's
of his
tough guy.
Company?
He's the guy that... When you go out to bars at the weekend, and there's always that tough guy in the bar who thinks he can take everybody on all at once,
yeah,
and it makes you not want to go. The bully, and it makes you not want to go to bars because of people like him.
I've been accused.
That's War Machine.
But
that's War Machine. Only when you drink hard alcohol.
Yeah, but if
hard
I'm at a bar, I'm drinking hard liquor. His T-shirt clothing company is I Do Alpha Male Shit. An alpha male means like you're the man of the room.
Right.
That's
right.
What an alpha male is.
Right.
You're the dominant male of the room.
Right.
That team Alpha Male is Uriah Faber's team. Rampage always talks about Alpha Male. But his clothing company, War Machine, was I Do Alpha Male Shit. And like we talked about, he's not only has he got a history of DUI and violent crimes and stuff, battery and assault, but he's a wacko. He changed his name to War Machine.
He's a weirdo.
Because of Rhino and TNA. Threatening to sue him because of the War Machine Rhino.
So he said, I'll go out and change my
name. Yeah, like Ultimate Warrior. Like, I'll just change my name and then what the fuck are you going to say? But, that was the weekend fights.
Talk about what happened today in Brazil.
Today in Brazil was the...
We're going to get the UFC and MMA news.
It'll take all 2 minutes.
And then we're good to go.
UFC 179 Media Day took place today at a soccer stadium in Brazil. As you
big
me.
Stadium, man.
Yeah,
like
Marcarena. Marcarena.
Right.
It's not Macarena like that. I remember that dance.
It's MARCANA. Everybody knows the Macarena. See, this is the time where I wish we had like a somebody sitting over here
with a stopwatch. All right,
no, stop. No. Somebody sitting over here with a fucking switchboard that. Right. Somebody like that. Isn't it Baba Booey that does it?
No, but he's the producer, Fred's the sound machine guy.
All right, somebody that's over there playing music so when we get out of the
podcast. I've tried doing that, and anytime I hit a sound effect while you're in the middle of a passionate fucking thing...
I get pissed.
Dude, stop it! I'm trying to fucking talk, and I'm like, just ignore it.
Because you overdo it.
No, I don't.
You overdo
it. It's funny to the listeners. Right. If you can ignore it, they don't even... But, Mendes and Aldo. Chad Mendes, Jose Aldo, Soccer Stadium Brazil, UFC 179 Media Day. They do the stare down after whatever... And very intense stare down.
Right.
As grudge matches often are, they've been accusing each other of PEDs, this and that, going back and forth on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
So they finally are face to face for the first time, and they're very intense. And then Aldo pushes them, and Chad tries to fucking get up and push him back, and they're separated quickly. So
everything was good up until that point, though. I mean, they had a couple of different stare downs. Everything was cool.
Yeah. Real intense, though. I mean, they're nose to nose, and their eyes. You could tell they mean business.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
But it wasn't a Jones Cormier situation.
No,
they jumped right in, and they had like 80 guys.
They were
kind of like fucking last night's Raw with the. We'll get into that later with the big, pull apart with the Bella.
You like the Bella twin segment?
No.
Is that what I heard?
Please say that for later. I did not say I liked it.
All right,
and I have a very big speech about.
Hey, let me bring up one other thing before we move on. Night of Champions, y'all. I listen. Y'all are gonna call me crazy in the chat room. This dude is probably gonna lay into me. John Cena wins the WWE title back at Night of Champions.
No, he doesn't.
Y'all are gonna call me crazy, but and I may be wrong. I very well might be wrong, but I'm gonna stick to my guns.
He's gonna,
and I'm saying.
You know what? I'm gonna save it for later.
Unless it ends via DQ.
If you watched Raw last night,
Cena wins that title back.
If you watched Raw last night and really paid attention,
they tried to put Cena over huge.
Well, they put him over as he's now entering this dark side, where he's not only was he manhandling Bray Wyatt and one side beating him down, but he would yell at him and taunt him. Stay down!
Yeah.
Stay down! Like, he's showing this dark side.
This dark side?
And he said during the build-up to SummerSlam, I might have to do some stuff that my fans won't like, blah, blah, blah. Basically saying I'm going to cheat to win. You know, that kind of shit. So what's going to happen? And he said last night on Raw, in addition to the teasing that he's going to go dark and really become an animal and that people might not like, but he's got to do it.
People may not like it, but he's got to do it to survive. To beat Brock Lesnar.
He made it very clear in a very quick opening segment promo, which we'll detail later. He says, I'm not coming to Night of Champions to beat Brock Lesnar.
I'm coming to Night of Champions to beat Brock Lesnar's ass.
Exactly. So maybe he does some cheating stuff and... Or even after the match loses cool, he might fuck him up. But 1-2-3, Lesnar wins. Or a fucking DQ, which could suck.
I am surprised. I gotta be honest.
You know what? He's gonna get DQ'd.
I am surprised.
He's gonna turn to the dark side, do something drastic, and get DQ'd. So where he doesn't win the title, but he beats Brock Lesnar's ass.
This is my feeling. This is my feeling going into it, okay? This is, and I'm gonna go deep here. And I know Boone always says, oh, you're looking over. Listen. We're going into Night of Champions, okay?
Oh my God.
The pay-per-view name is Night of Champions.
I love how it was
last night on Raw, they made John Cena out to be, like Boone said, I've got to show a darker side, no matter how I got to beat Brock Lesnar, I got to go in there, I got to do it. Some of my fans may not like it, I got to do it. What better way than to have, and Ric Flair was on Raw last night in a segment with John Cena, and Ric Flair numerous times during his promo said, you're a 15-time world champ, you're a 15-time world champ.
And he said it before he came
out. You go in to Night of Champions, John Cena somehow, some way defeats Brock Lesnar. Do I agree with it? No. But Brock's not going to be there from now until WrestleMania, like we talked about last week. Brock's, I don't think he's going to be there. He could be.
They might have restructured.
They could have restructured the contract like we got into last week. I don't know. But I don't think Brock is going to be there from now until WrestleMania. With that being said, house shows, live events, I feel like you can't go from now until WrestleMania with your WWE World Heavyweight title not being featured on house shows. I don't see how that happens from now until WrestleMania. So,
somebody brought up a good.
So I think Cena wins the title at Night of Champions. Night of Champions. He's 16-time World Heavyweight Champion.
Literally, Rick
Flair's
you,
in the mix. Rick Flair's in the mix now. Rick Flair's.
Do you know why Rick Flair was in the mix on Monday?
Yeah, because the Emmy Awards
had nothing to do with the storyline. They wanted three big names,
but they don't have anything.
They
don't have anything. They don't have anything for Ric Flair. So what better way to put him in something?
So next week he's going to be part of it still. He's in it now.
I hope that Ric Flair's back on Raw next week. I hope
Ric Flair's not on Raw. On Raw and in the mix with Cena and Lesnar.
No, probably not.
Of course not.
The only
reason he was on Raw, as well as Hogan, as well as Michaels, all at the same time, was to combat the Emmys at the start of the show and try and maintain their viewership, which didn't work. Numbers dropped this week. You'll get into that later. But, listen, we'll see what happens.
John Cena going on.
I disagree.
All right, no doubt. I'm kind of surprised when we first started talking about this.
It's about 50-50.
A lot of people
agree with you.
And last week they were all against me saying you are crazy for saying that John Cena's going to win at 90. All of you guys in the chat
I think Raw
were against
them.
Me last week, and maybe Raw convinced
and
them
guess
last
what?
Night that...
That was the entire point.
That was the point. It
that
may
was
have
the
been the
entire
point.
Point.
It may have been the
Make
point.
Make it believable, and then when you get there...
Listen... John Cena is their golden boy. This dude is he's their guy. He's their main dude, right? So have him take out a guy that defeated the streak, ended the streak, a guy that won the title, but then the problem
not just
is,
won the title.
Then the problem is
one-sided squash match against
one-sided
Cena.
One-sided squash
never happens before in a main event.
Right, but
so John you're telling me Brock Lesnar in his first title defense loses the belt. Very first time he's defending the belt.
I know. But John Cena's, dude, he's their golden boy, bro. He's their man. He's their golden boy. I don't agree with
now
it.
We
if
can,
it happens,
there's
if,
plenty
if,
to get into.
If it happens, I don't agree with it. I think,
oh,
bro,
no. And this is the reverse of last week. He kept having me explain myself like it was my fucking idea last week. And I'm like, dude, I'm not saying I agree with it, or I think it's smart, or it was my idea. I'm just telling you what I think's going to happen. And now this week, he's over on the other foot over here. I'm not agreeing with it. I think it's stupid.
I don't.
That's why I think it's going to happen.
I said that
that's
last
what I said
week.
Last week.
I said that later. I said, yo, I think that Brock Lesnar should not lose until WrestleMania, but the way that his current contract is structured, unless they've restructured it,
they,
we don't know
they
that.
They had to have. I would think they would have. I don't know that.
You would think.
But I would think.
You would think.
They wouldn't have had him demolish Taker and then fucking
and then demolish
Cena. Squash match Cena on the second biggest show of the year.
And then have Cena defeat him.
And then in the very next show, his first title defense, he loses the belt to the same guy he beat him.
Dude, I can.
How do you go from squashing a guy to not even being able to beat him?
No, how do you go from ending Taker's streak and then squashing WWE's main golden boy?
And then Hulk Hogan and Stone Cold of this era.
And then having Cena defeat him at Night of Champions. But
very next show.
Like I said last week, it's WWE. We've seen their logic time and time again where it's mind-boggling. We come on here and we say, what the fuck were they thinking? And I think this is another example of that where Cena wins the title at Night of Champions and we all come on here post-Monday, post-Tuesday, and we say, wow, I can't, but I'm going to beat John Cena.
If Brock Lesnar beats John Cena
at
Night of Champions,
it'll
almost bring a tear to my eye.
Yeah, okay.
No, that was Brock Lesnar's closing line. And his
Yeah.
I tried to sell it the same way. All right, but there's plenty to talk about
when
we get
into
that. It's not like I just exploded the whole point I had to make.
No,
sure.
We're going
to
get into it.
I've got a couple of other things
we'll talk about
into that.
The Bella Twins, too.
Oh, no, I'm talking about Lesnar. Cena. Yeah, I got a lot to say about Bella. MMA, though. Aldo Mendez punched him, blah, blah, blah. They separated him. So that was that. Dana White is in trouble with the UFC.
Yes, he is.
For removing a judge. He didn't like the way a judge was scoring some fights. Removed the judge at the China show, Bisping Kung Lee, because they were governing their own show because they're not under a state athletic commission like Nevada State Athletic Commission, New Jersey State Athletic Commission. So they're their own athletic commission for the China show. And because they are, Dana White has the authority to pull a judge in the middle of the show if he doesn't like his scores. Turns out he doesn't have the authority.
Well, he did anyway.
He does to do it, but after the fact, he's in breach of the regulatory protocol, as they call it.
Right.
It was against their protocol on how they govern themselves. When they're in a situation where they're their own commission,
right,
he can do it, against their policy.
Tell people, in America, we all have athletic commissions.
Yeah, if they're under the Nevada State Athletic Commission.
Jersey, wherever they are.
That's the government, in a sense. That's his
UFC
big quote.
UFC does not control them, the athletic commission.
Yeah. They appoint the judges. They appoint the referees.
Everybody.
All that stuff. And even if Dana thinks that like a referee's incompetent or the judges suck, it doesn't matter. If the commission appoints them, he can't do nothing about it.
They were overseas.
John Jones, I'm sorry, has one loss on his record.
Right.
To Matt Hamill. And that was a mistake of a referee.
Yeah.
It was a DQ for doing elbows like this. 12 to 6, they call it.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of a warning the fucking guy, they just disqualified him because Hamill couldn't continue. So because of that, a guy that's the best fucking fighter in the sport, should be able to promote him as the undefeated, unstoppable champ. They can't say undefeated. They got to say 17-1 or whatever his record is, you know?
So they were overseas in China?
Macau, China.
China, okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And they don't have a governing body over there.
Not for MMA.
Athletic commission. So UFC was able to pick their own judges, their own, score people.
They appointed their own judges, And it turns out the guy that he removed, Howard Hughes, used to be a fighter, by the way. I believe he was in UFC 2 or something like that.
Dana apologized today.
Yeah.
Correct?
At the press conference in Brazil where they announced, it was the Cain Velasquez, Fabricio Verdum.
Right.
They announced 5 fights. Like, Diego Sanchez is on that card. Jake Ellenberger is on
big
that card.
Fights,
a lot of big fights on it. Ricardo Lamas versus Dennis Bermudez would just be Clay Guida.
Yeah.
A lot of big fights on that card. He took the time, I think, a reporter asked him about it, and he apologized and said, I shouldn't have done it. I got lost my cool. He was like, you guys know me. I'm a hothead. I lose my cool. I lost my cool. I thought the judge sucked, and I overreacted.
Good for him, man, to admit your mistake.
He's the most honest fucker in the world.
All right, one last thing, and then we're going to do the plugs, and then we're getting into Monday Night Raw.
Not the most honest motherfucker in the world, but he's honest, usually. He's,
yeah.
A promoter, you can never call any promoter honest, no matter how honest they seem. Promoters are...
Of course.
A little bit of a...
Absolutely. All right, one last thing before we move on, then we're going to get into Monday Night Raw. A lot of talk about TNA Impact, where are they going, Spike TV. A
lot of velocity behind those TNA rumors.
A lot of velocity. Keep your eye on TV as well, by the way.
Keep your eye on that story, folks.
Keep your eye on that story. So, here's the deal.
You fucking one-up me again, I'm fucking walking out of this room. I tell you right now, I'm the funny guy on this show.
All
right,
so here's the deal.
Son of a bitch.
Here's the deal. TNA Impact, you guys know that Spike TV has renewed them through 2014.
Just to the end of the year, yeah.
Just till the end of the
year.
Get them through Bound for Glory. And
so that Spike can announce their next schedule for the beginning of the year.
Right.
Without replacing it at the end, in the middle of a year, you know. A
lot of talk that Spike TV wants out of the wrestling business.
They're done. Because there were rumors that they wanted to buy a company or buy TNA. Absolutely. They want nothing to do with wrestling.
So the idea of extending them through 2014 is, I thought I grabbed the right chair.
I'm going to get up and switch.
Are you? The other one sounded worse. I'm giving you a fair warning, man.
We have two chairs that squeak?
The other one sounded worse. Remember?
Is it blue one? It is. Fuck.
I think that's the worst one, bro.
Keep talking. Do your thing.
Okay. All right. Is that better? All right, no doubt. All right.
It's never until I get over here that
you're sweet. All right, so here's the deal. Been a lot of talk that, like Boone just said, that Spike TV wants out of the pro wrestling business. So, the idea here is this... Fuck the town, man. All right, so the idea here is that Spike TV has extended their contract through 2014 as basically just being nice.
Address this real quick. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
They're going to the Discovery.
The Discovery Network owns
Velocity. Yeah. Right. So we'll get into that here in just a second, why Discovery is in this.
Because there was talk that Jeff Jarrett's Global Force was going to go to the Discovery Channel, if you remember.
I've heard that Jeff Jarrett has been in talks with CMT and WGN. Now, I don't know
Discovery, I heard at one point, yeah.
I don't know if WGN may be interested in Impact now that they've got a more established product. I don't know what the deal... Basically, the four networks that are interested right now are Velocity, which would be a worst-case scenario for TNA as they're only in 48 million homes, and they're only broadcast in high definition.
That's a big deal. Like you said, I couldn't
watch
that.
But Spike TV has, I think, close to 100 million homes. I believe close to 100 million. If they go to Velocity, you're looking at 48 million. You're cutting that in half. So their viewership is...
I believe Spike TV is available anywhere you got cable.
I think it's about 100 million
homes. So however many homes are accessible to cable should be able to get Spike, I would believe.
I thought it was about 100 million. But yeah, but you may be right.
Yeah, but maybe there's only 100 million homes that get cable.
Yeah, but it depends what provider you're on. I mean, Time Warner may have it, but Comcast may not carry it.
You know,
like
I think every... I think... I'm talking out of my ass because I don't know, but I don't ever recall, and I've been in a lot of different states and hotels that have different cable
companies.
I've always
had Spike TV.
Any cable system I've ever had has Spike. It used to be TNN.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, and I don't ever recall a cable provider having that.
I've never seen something about 100. But anyways,
we're not debating the number. I'm talking about the availability.
The networks that are interested are Velocity, which pretty much would be a worst case scenario, especially because they're only in high definition.
It'd be the equivalent, damn near, of Ring of Honor being on Sinclair.
Ion TV's...
Like, who has heard of Velocity?
I know, up until
this story.
Ion TV, there's been talks about that, but they recently dropped Main Event. Part of Main Event being dropped is because WWE said we're going to the network instead. We're going to air it on a first run basis on the network, and then you guys can have the replay. And Ion TV said, no, we're not. Fuck you, dude. We want the first run. And WWE and them couldn't come to a suitable negotiation. And basically said that we're out. So Ion TV said we're out. But that's not to say that they're not interested in wrestling. WGN is a station based out of Chicago. They've expanded nationally around the United States in recent years. So that's a fairly
big
network.
Yeah, I had it in Florida.
And then
WGN. Yeah, I had that in Florida.
Right.
There was something I would even watch on WGN. So
they
that
were
was like
originally
a regular stop for me.
That was originally based out of just Chicago, Illinois, and then they expanded into a broader network and went across the entire United States. And the other network that was interested is I said Velocity.
Yeah. Velocity, Ion, and WGN is the one.
And WGN, and of course Spike TV is the other one that they're already on. But so where do they go from here? I mean, Spike TV, if they lose Spike TV, it's going to be a big loss no matter what. You know, I mean, Spike TV's where they're going to gain probably the most viewership, unless they come up with some other crazy wild network that, like an MTV or a VH1 or something like that.
Get the fuck out
which
of
my face. That's not going to happen. But and then somebody brought up Discovery. Explain that.
Well, like you said, Discovery Network owns the Velocity Channel the same way that Viacom
owns CBS and Spike TV, yes, and people like that.
And NBC Universal owns USA Network and that
correct
kind of shit. So
correct,
the Discovery Network owns the Velocity Channel, the Discovery right Channel.
I think Discovery owns, you know, like Animal Planet and things
yes
like that as well. So it's kind
it
of a
sounds
situation
right to me. I don't know that, but it sounds right.
It's a situation like that where although Discovery is the main network
right
in not
I know it should be PAX. I remember PAX back in
I
the
do
day
remember PAX.
There was something
right
I would watch in that. Maybe like Herman's Head or something. I don't
right
know, but there was something I'd watch
right
in that.
Yeah. So anyways, it's going to be interesting for TNA to see what happens here at the end of 2014. We know that Dixie Carter is not involved in negotiations. It's basically the, what is it, the talent agency,
UTA.
UTA. I wanted to say AG. AEG. But that's Michael Jackson and the
that's
concert
an insurance
promoter
company.
It's the
no
concert promoter.
What am I thinking of? What's the insurance
company? AEG is the concert promoter that
AGI
promotes concerts all over.
I don't know. There's
it may be an insurance company. You
there's
may be
something
right
close that's it's either that
AEG
one or something very similar.
It had, AEG had something to do with Michael Jackson, and I think it might have been insurance.
You know, it would be a great guy to find out that from.
Live Nation is the concert promoter.
Shalik.
Yeah,
but, he's a Michael Jackson.
Live Nation.
Live
Nation
is the concert promoter that bought
so
out Jay-Z's rights for his
AEG may be a you may be right on that. You may be right. All right. But anyway, so it'll be interesting to see what happens.
I think it's AIG is the insurance one.
AEG.
No, AIG is the insurance.
Oh, the insurance.
Yeah,
company.
I don't know what the hell AEG is.
What happens? We know that Dixie Carter
yes,
is not involved in negotiations. Okay. And the UTA Talent Agency, which is a major talent agency that represents top name A-list yeah celebrities, as well as companies like TNA.
Kind of like William Morris.
Things.
It's a big one.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. William Morris, look at you. I'm surprised you knew
Howard
that.
Stern.
I'm surprised
yeah
you knew
yeah
that.
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah.
So, anyways,
you
don't
gotta
check
go to
out
TMZ to know
hey
everything.
Right. And one last thing, and then we're gonna get into Monday Night Raw from last night. You just brought up Howard Stern.
There you go.
Howard Stern took part in the ALS Ice Bucket Challenge,
mm-hmm,
and basically,
he did
was
a nice shot last.
It
challenge
was pretty fucking funny,
yeah,
man. I mean, I give him credit. You and I, my friend, were challenged by
my sister,
your sister Jamie, and I believe
John Morgan
in the chat room, and a couple other people,
couple of other guys
on my Facebook
yeah
page have tagged you and I in your Facebook page as well. You've given us 24 hours. One quick thing I want to say, and I know we're way past the 24-hour deadline. We actually talked last night, and we were going to say, you know, at the end of this show tonight, let's surprise them. We'll give them
yeah
a little surprise.
It was my idea. I told him, I said, let's not even mention it during
the show.
We won't
even mention it.
And then at the very end, just fucking
then,
do it.
And then,
and I was going to bring it up during the commercial and still do it tonight, by the way. So you
right
just kind of ruined that. But
well, here's the deal. We've got carpet underneath us. I was going to grab a piece of plastic.
Water.
I was going to put it there. We were going to do it. I want to do it big. I want buckets. Okay?
We got to be outside.
I got a couple buckets out there. I want to do it big. And not only that, but a lot of these people, they're donating, or they're doing the Ice Bucket Challenge, but they're not donating to the cause. Nobody says anything about the cause. So I'm going to say it right here, and we're going to say it again. We're going to do this by the weekend. By the end of this weekend, we'll have a video up. We're going to have somebody record it. We'll go outside. We'll do it. We'll dump some ice water
on it. I had an idea earlier of how to do it funny.
we'll think of something.
I got like a little script we could follow. Where
we'll,
it would be like a funny idea.
We'll think of something, and we're going to have it up by the weekend. But listen, while we're on here tonight, go to ALS.org. They've raised $88 million as of the last check, which is yesterday. Yeah, yesterday afternoon, it was $88 million, but nobody says any. Everybody goes out and dumps ice water over their head, and they challenge other people, but nobody ever says, go to ALS.org
some of them
and donate.
Do.
Some of them do. I can't say everybody.
Yeah,
but
no, a lot of them have.
So, I'm going to say it here. It's
what's your favorite ALS video so far? I have a definite answer.
Again, let me think about it.
Let me give you mine, and then maybe it'll jog your memory a little bit. Bully Ray and Velvet Sky was my favorite.
That was good. That was
they
good.
They did like a whole Stone
Stunner
Cold
and
a Mick Foley
and
thing.
Everything else.
Yeah,
that was good.
I thought it was really good. And it made me wonder, and it looked like someone's house. Is Bully Ray fucking Velvet
yes.
Sky? Are
yes.
they really?
Yes.
Oh, that son of a bitch.
You
is so
listen.
Lucky.
You listen to the interview
Ooh.
Where Bully Ray, just about a month or two, had said that, yeah, I used to date Brooke Hogan, and I'm now dating
now,
Velvet
Sky. No, that was
Sky.
A storyline, the Brooke
no,
Hogan.
No, it was not.
That was
it
not real.
It was not. Bully Ray told a story about how Hulk Hogan and Bully Ray had a talk, a legitimate talk, and that they were dating in real life. I have photos up on TNA Wrestling News of them out in a bar holding hands and kissing and everything else.
Yeah, but Hulk's known for keeping his shit legit off air.
I know you guys heard that interview with Bully Ray. Bully Ray and Brooke Hogan were dating. Tell him.
I'm not denying it. I'm just saying I never heard of it.
All right. They were dating. Then he moved on to Velvet Sky.
Lucky son of a
yeah.
bitch.
And he's an ugly
He's ugly
fucker,
as fuck.
Right? That big ass nose. I'm looking at the video.
He's in
Bully
shape like a motherfucker, though. I was looking at his fucking arms.
Yeah.
In the video, because he wore the, where you're right here.
Yeah, he's jacked.
The motherfucker used to be a chubby,
but
fat
you know
piece of shit. Now he's like a fucking big brick wall.
Listen,
like, he's a fucking ox.
No,
now.
He was jacked. He's jacked in the arms.
He's got, like, tone and
he's
everything.
He's jacked in
oh,
the arms,
yeah, he's
but he's
got, the
got
belly.
A big belly. So
yeah.
He's got in there. And then, well, you bring this up, and we're talking about the ALS challenge. Mick Foley comes out with a video today.
I didn't watch it
It's
yet.
Him and his son, Dewey,
yeah.
right? Dude, Mick Foley has put on... Damn near.
Nobody in the chat has heard of Bubba and Velvet Sky, by the way. But anyway,
yeah, you guys heard that interview.
Read it.
Man.
I'm just telling you what they said.
Saying Bully Ray was on there with Sam Roberts, a guy that does excellent interviews.
Oh, did he? I don't
he
watch
was on
those.
There with
I
Sam
put them
Roberts,
up, but I don't
he
watch.
Was being
I know
real,
you're
was,
a fan of him.
He was
yeah.
being real as shit. But Mick Foley has put on 50 to 100 pounds. I mean, he looked huge today. I'm looking
he
at
did.
That video today. I said, "Wow!"
Listen, he's not working. Even when he was in ring shape, he was
it's a
fucking
lot of weight.
Mess.
It's a lot of weight.
Yeah, but
to put
if you're
on,
in
man.
Ring shape, that's cardio galore. People don't understand
right.
how much cardio goes into pro wrestling, and cardio is what'll get you in shape.
Right.
And in his best cardio ring shape physique, he was a fucking mess.
He was a mess. You're
so
right.
So obviously,
right.
when you start eating and you're not training and you're not in cardio ring shape anymore, you're gonna let it go.
Right.
And he's older.
All right. You know. So here we go, brother.
He doesn't have good genetics.
The official website of WZR TV Tuesdays, WZROnline.com, at 8:41 p.m. We're just doing the plugs. The official website of WZR TV, WZROnline.com. We are on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Go to Facebook.com/WZRArmy, YouTube.com/WZRArchive. We're on Twitter as well. Just go to WZROnline.com, top navigation bar, social media tab, drop-down menu. It's got all the links to Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube, WZROnline.com. The official website of WZR TV Tuesdays. Bada-bing, bada-boom. Boom. Okay.
There you go. What does Stardust do like this?
I don't know what he does. It doesn't go less.
He blows the dust off his hands. Yeah.
Alright, here we go. Get to our live chat room, WZR
they
Online.
They turned heel, by the way.
They did,
though.
Right, WZROnline.com/chat, WZROnline.com/chat, WZROnline.com/chat. Lots and lots of people in there, as always, tonight. Monday Night Raw from last night. First thing I'll point out, no authority, Triple H, Stephanie McMahon.
A lot of people missing last
no
night.
Randy Orton.
No
Chris Jericho.
No Dean Ambrose.
Dean Ambrose.
No Randy Orton. No Chris Jericho. No Triple H. No Stephanie McMahon. And there's one other that
there's
I can't
one
remember.
One other that I'm not
there was a
of.
Lot of star power missing from that show. A
lot of people.
And one of the stars, Bray Wyatt, was used as like a fucking jobber at the end of the show until he made it a six-man. He kind of got a little back, but he was yeah. getting jobbed out to Cena in like a squash fashion the same way Cena did to Lesnar, which to me was like, and we'll disagree here, because I'm thinking... And I wrote about this on Facebook. I started becoming more active on Facebook again.
Yeah.
I said that they're squashing Bray Wyatt to get Cena whole again for the rematch with Lesnar, which he's going to lose anyway. So why the fuck are they ruining Bray Wyatt in the process? I said you disagree, but
I told you last week, man. Bray Wyatt, that gimmick is stale. It's just, I don't, it's...
They need to do something quick before it gets...
Right?
Yeah, because it's one of those caricatures, cartoon versions of what it was.
Same promo week after week, and it makes no sense whatsoever, and he just rambles on and on, and then he's kind of lost.
I've been saying that since day one, and I was the first guy to really say, because you, in the beginning, didn't even like Bray Wyatt or the Wyatt family.
No, I didn't. You're right.
And then eventually you got on the bandwagon. But I've been saying since about 3 or 4 months into the run, I'm like, and I made it very clear, his promos are cool, and they come off cool, and they sound cool, and that's why people like him. But there's not a lot of substance to what he's saying. It sounds cool, the delivery is very cool, but he's not really saying anything. And eventually he's got to say something to connect on a deeper level with the fan in the chair.
And, and give it to WWE. I mean, WWE put him in a storyline and a major match with John Cena, and I think he got the rub from Cena. I mean, Bray Wyatt, when he came in, we used to know Bray Wyatt as Husky Harris back in the day from NXT, this, that, and the other thing. But Bray Wyatt's been elevated big time in recent months. He's been elevated big time in recent months. I mean, we can't deny that. I mean, the guy started out as just a kind of a creeper, right?
With Kane,
Husky
and then,
Harris, everything else. He's been elevated big time ever since that John Cena feud and match and everything else. So you got to give WWE credit for that. But now it's a matter of John Cena's kind of moved on to other things with Brock Lesnar and
that was
Bray Wyatt.
Daniel Bryan's injury,
Bray Wyatt, you know, went into an angle with Chris Jericho. We know that Chris Jericho's leaving after Night of Champions.
I've been talking that they might not even do Jericho Wyatt again.
Right. And where does Bray go after?
They might do Jericho Orton because of that highlight reel now.
You've already started. I mean, he's already been with Cena. He's already been with Jericho, unless they do, you know, a third match at
He's already been with Kane and the Authority and all that. He's already been with the Shield.
And Randy Orton, you just brought up Randy Orton's kind of lost in the shuffle right now. Unless they want to do Reigns versus Orton. I mean, they already did that, but they could do it again. Reigns Orton again.
They could, and I'm not saying they won't, but they need to be careful doing too many rematches on this Night of Championship because this is the show that gets those 6 month commitments back.
All right, so let's get it.
I think they might be doing Reigns Rollins based on last night, or Reigns Kane.
No, there was talk of doing a tag team match between Dean Ambrose, maybe back by Night of Champions, they're talking about.
Yeah, but they'd have to be able to promote it ahead of time.
Right, but I meant to listen. Dean Ambrose is out filming a film right now.
Until the
20th.
The 21st is
not champion. That's not to say that there may not be a Monday that he could fly into Raw. Even tape some filming. I don't know where they're taping right now. I don't know where Dean Ambrose is taping.
Yeah, they got the camera crews, obviously.
It's not to say that Dean Ambrose couldn't film during the day. And if their filming location is near where Raw is being held, have Dean Ambrose jump on a private jet or a regular jet and fly into Raw.
The Rock
did angle, do an angle real quick, and then go back to shooting the following day.
The Rock did that when he was working with Cena in a very important WrestleMania match.
Right.
He would be on location, but because they needed his presence on the show,
he would just stand out
there, and it was almost like a cell phone video. Mm-hmm. You know, but it worked.
Or do something. I mean, listen, I understand if you're 15 hours away and it's a 15-hour flight back and forth, then there's going to be no way to do that. But if it's only a 2-3-4-hour plane ride back and forth, then bring them into Raw. Do an
angle. I like your idea of pre-taping something, but I don't know, man. I don't know.
But they could do that. They could do a tag team match with Roman Reigns, Dean Ambrose against Seth Rollins.
You got me menthol light, you piece of shit.
Is that what they were? She said there were two different packs.
I'm going to need like two for every one cigarette. They're weak as fuck.
Stop. You whiny
fucking bitch. And I hate 100.
You whiny fucking bitch. All right. Monday Night Raw from last night. Stay, man. Talk about it.
Didn't really like it.
Yeah? How you like that cigarette?
It's all right, actually.
I only smoked one cigarette tonight.
Congratulations. This is my fourth one. But
you
anyways.
Guys noticed that? I've smoked a half a cigarette the entire hour number one. Give me a golf clap. Round of applause.
Yeah, no, I didn't really particularly care for last night.
Why is it two different? Watch. Why is the thing? You see that?
Yeah, the one camera is on that. Yeah, I don't know. Anyways, no. Yes. You asked me what I thought of the show. I didn't particularly like it that much. No.
I didn't either.
I didn't think it was that strong.
I thought the opening segment, they plugged these Hall of Famers coming in, right? We've got Ric Flair, Shawn Michaels, Hulk Hogan coming in. They're going to kick off Monday Night Raw. We're going head-to-head with the Emmy Awards this week. It's a big deal. And then they get out there, and the panel takes place.
I thought this was terrible.
And I'll tell you right now why it was terrible.
Tell me.
You watch those pre-shows before a pay-per-view, or, and they even do it for Raw, the pre-show.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed like a pre-show that was setting, what's the word for setting if it's in a different tense? It was a pre-show that took place in the ring instead of up on the balcony in the arena somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
It was three guys at a table giving their predictions. If you've got Hogan, Flair, Michaels, why not involve them in the storylines?
Right.
Have one of them out there, Hogan, Flair, whoever, and then fucking, you know, Heyman come out. Maybe not Lesnar because he's not there, but Heyman could come out and say, listen, Hulkster. You know, and he could start doing something with him, you know, and then it
turns
something. To have them just sitting there, oh, I think this guy's going to win. No, I think this guy's going to win. You're wrong, Hulkster. This guy's going to win.
Or
that does nothing for anyone.
Or involve Ric Flair in the storyline, so when we get to the Night of Champions pay-per-view, 16-time world champion, Night of Champions.
They covered that, even in the shitty panel
setting. My bad.
They covered that. But my point is, they wasted having three huge names there, and it didn't add anything to the match.
Yeah.
How much?
They completely wasted.
Let me ask you this one simple question.
Yes, sir.
Are you more excited to see Cena, Lesnar 2? Or three, if you count Extreme Rules 2 years ago.
Okay.
Are you more excited to see the rematch between Cena and Lesnar Night of Champions because of that Hogan, Flair, and Michaels panel? Or after
absolutely
that panel, are you like, now I can't wait for the
absolutely
match?
Absolutely not.
Of course not.
It didn't do anything.
It did nothing.
The match.
They wanted star power, big names, recognizable figures at the start of the show to combat the Emmys. That was it.
I guess when Cena came out there and Cena was, you know, when Cena had a line to Hulk Hogan where he said something like, I want you to look at me when I'm talking
to
you.
That was interesting.
And that's the new guy. But Hogan looked right at him. I mean, Hogan didn't.
And Hogan was the only one.
Hogan didn't try to no-sell it.
But he had glasses on, so you don't know what his eyes were doing. But Hogan was the only one, if you remember, the predictions. Flair and Michaels are pretty much saying, everybody knows when their time is coming.
Hogan was the only guy to pick Cena.
You should retire, he's not going to win, you're never the same after a beating like that. Hogan was the only guy, brother, that thought Cena could do it. And then he was the guy that Cena said, Hogan, I want you to look at me when I say this. And it was kind of like, what the fuck was that? Like the other guys are the ones that look at me.
I got it. Hogan and Cena against Flair and Michaels.
All right, that's enough. No, I think you already said it. I think it was the beginning.
It's not gonna happen, trust me.
I think it was the beginning, like we saw in the Bray Wyatt match, which turned into a six-man later in the show. It was the beginning stages of Cena showing that edge. Hogan, I want you to look at me, and people are like, ooh, you know, that edge.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't even think of that until you just said it. I think that's what that was.
You may have been right. You may be right.
But why they focused that edge on the one guy supporting him as opposed to the other two,
now,
who he put over and said he respected, it would have worked much better with those two guys because they were the negative Nellies.
Now,
what
do you think of Cena saying, I'm going in the Night of Champions, and I'm not just going
to... I already told you.
I'm not just going to beat John Cena. Just going to beat Brock Lesnar. I'm going to beat his ass.
No, that's wrong. That's the wrong quote.
Okay.
It's not, I'm not just gonna be. He says, I'm not going to Night of Champions to beat Brock Lesnar. I'm going to beat his ass, which means, in my opinion, I don't care about winning or losing. I care about fucking that motherfucker up.
I guess.
If he said, I'm not going there just to beat Brock Lesnar, I'm going there to beat him up, that means not only do I want to win, I want to hurt him.
He didn't
say that. He said, I'm not going there to win. I'm going there to beat someone up, you know.
When I'm going into a fight, I'm going in there to beat somebody, whether it be beating them or beating their ass. I'm going into a fight, I'm beating somebody's ass.
Yeah.
All right? Whether
you've heard that,
beating them or I'm beating their ass, I'm beating somebody.
But it's kind of the equivalent to that tough guy quote where you say,
I guess.
Where you say, listen, he might beat my ass, but he'll know he's been in a fight. I'll break his nose. Even if he beats me up, he'll know he's been in a fight.
He may beat me. Or he may beat my ass. It's the same fucking thing. He's gonna beat you. He's either gonna beat you or he's gonna beat your ass.
That's not what he said.
He said
what he's gonna do to him, not what he's gonna do to me. He said, I'm not going there to beat him. I'm going there to beat his ass. Which I interpret as, I don't care about winning, I care about hurting him.
Okay.
That's how I see where you're coming from. But that's what he said.
I get it. I know that's what he said. But the line, when he said it, I'm like, that sounds
corny. I'm not going there to beat him.
Listen,
I'm going there to beat his ass.
That whole promo was designed to basically make himself whole again.
I get it.
No, I'm not arguing with you. I'm moving to a different subject.
Right.
He comes off of this squash match loss, which he's never had in a 15-year, whatever the fuck it's been, career.
Right.
The idea of that promo and that segment was convince people. This is why what you saw happen at SummerSlam happened, and
I ain't fucking around this time.
And this is why you should order Night of Champions, because it's It's not going to be the same.
Right.
This is why it's going to be different. And I didn't get that after it was done. I didn't feel when it was over like, oh, that's why it's going to be different.
And the Legends.
To me, it's like, all right, it's the same match.
And the Legends.
He's just claiming it's not going to happen again. All right, well, you need
Legends,
to explain to me
Legends
why.
We're out there for no reason. They didn't do anything.
It was star power to combat the Emmys. That was it for those guys.
That's it.
That was the only reason they were there.
And Raw and the Emmys started the same time.
Yeah, they added nothing to the storyline, but they might have added something to the people who were interested in both shows.
People that are tuning through.
Stay here, let's put it down, at least for this segment.
People that are tuning through, they see Hogan, Michaels, and Flair in a ring. It was like, whoa, I'm going to stop
here. It was the Monday Night Wars.
I'm going to stop here for a second.
The guys that used to be here with WWF and WCW, and then they would see DX come out. Oh, shit, I'm chilling for a minute. I don't want to watch this. I think they thought that the people who would be both interested in the Emmys and wrestling would be like, oh, fuck, Hogan, Flair, and Michaels. Let me see what happens.
Right.
And then nothing happened, so.
All right, we had Rusev beat Swagger via ref stoppage.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, we can skip that,
That
right?
went on for too long, that stoppage bullshit.
Oh, I know.
He just kicked him in the stomach, like, for literally about 2 full minutes. He just kick. And the ref said, all right, that's enough.
JBL was all over Swagger for letting his country down.
A lot of people have been, who was it? Seth Rollins has brought it up. Bo Dallas has brought it up. JBL brings it up all the time.
Well, Bo was later in the night. Bo came back and
said,
that's
the new program.
You know,
right. Swagger.
That was right after the break, too. Bo Dallas was backstage.
Yeah, Swagger was backstage, getting taped up.
That's what it was.
Yeah, and Dallas came in and fucked with him.
Cesaro pinned Rob Van Dam. I thought these two meshed pretty fucking well on Raw. Yes.
I didn't.
You didn't?
I thought, like we had mentioned last week, Their first few matches, and they've had a lot of matches together.
Mm-hmm.
You would think just on paper, RVD, Cesaro, the way that's going to be
great match, right?
Awesome. And the timing, and it just didn't work.
The timing's been off.
Some guys' styles don't go together. They say styles make fights in MMA and boxing.
Right.
It's the same in wrestling. Styles make matches.
Right.
Their styles didn't work. Mm-hmm. And then for that pay-per-view, I think it was SummerSlam. Did they work at SummerSlam? The kickoff show.
Yep, on the kickoff.
That was a great fucking match.
Mm-hmm.
From what I remember.
I thought last night was pretty good, too.
I don't want to say it was bad,
but
I didn't think it was as good as SummerSlam.
I thought Sheamus on commentary.
Time.
I thought after the match, Sheamus was on commentary during the match, right? And going back and forth with JBL.
That's
after it was over, Cesaro, you know, he kept pointing to Sheamus during the match. So that's the next program.
That's what I was going to say. That's what,
But when Cesaro stole his U.S. title, right? And then took it and threw it in his face.
He did
that. Awesome.
He did that on SmackDown, I think, the week before too.
Did he?
Yeah, he kind of took it.
That was cool.
That was the reason. And thank you for reminding me. That was the reason why I didn't think the match was that good. I think it was more of let's establish that Cesaro's fucking with Sheamus the whole time.
Right.
And the match was kind of secondary. It was the commentary
leaving this week too.
After tonight, he's supposedly done.
Yeah.
At least for now.
Right.
You know, that's what I heard.
So that's the next feud. But you're absolutely right, dude, where they were trying to establish that this is the next
Cesaro, Sheamus is RVD secondary. The match is secondary. Let's focus on me fucking with Sheamus. Sheamus talking about me on commentary, ignoring the match, talking about the angle. It wasn't a good match in my opinion.
Yeah.
It's my opinion.
All right, they were just trying to get to the
Some
next
Some people feud. Like different things in a
They
match.
Were trying to get to the next feud, you know what I mean? So it was, I don't know, it did what it needed to do. All right, we had Paige defeated Natalya. The whole point here, speaking of good matches, for a Divas match, brother, Paige and Natalya last night was pretty fucking good. I gotta be honest with you, normally Divas matches, their piss breaks, right? Everybody goes.
They call them the popcorn
piss.
Match.
It's
yeah.
the popcorn match. Whatever, dude. I thought AJ and Natalya were pretty freaking good last night. And then, of course, AJ came out after and started skipping around the ring.
God, she looked good.
AJ.
Whatever she was wearing. Oh, my fucking God.
I know.
God.
You like them cargo pants that she had on?
Is that what she was wearing?
It was, like cargo
it was the
pants
gray. I remember the gray shirt with the tits. That's what I remember.
It was like cargo pants.
I didn't remember the pants.
I like the tight jeans a little bit better than the cargo pants. But what are you gonna do?
I like the shirts, the tops.
So AJ's playing games, right?
And I like crazy chicks too. She's hot and crazy, which makes you think that in bed she might be fucking up.
You know she's crazy.
I don't say that. I'm saying the character turns you on because it makes you think in your head. You fantasize and you're like, that bitch is crazy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So when we turn the lights out, she's going to be crazy. When if, we, you know.
If you've seen interviews with her in the past, though, she's a little bit on the...
Timid?
Timid, yeah,
like,
yeah.
Like apprehensive, like real, standoffish?
Like nerdy.
Nervous?
Like real nerdy.
Okay, nerdy.
Like nerd.
Like a dork.
Like a dork. Like
she
a
nerd. She was a big wrestling fan. There's that famous clip of her when she
with Lita?
Lita at the autograph sign.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Crying and all that. And that was a cartoon that went around the locker room for a while.
I know.
About Punk used to bang Lita, now he's banging...
And now he's banging AJ,
yeah,
right?
And AJ was like, oh, my God, now I've been everywhere Lita's
right,
been.
Right. So anyways, AJ comes out afterwards. Yeah. AJ starts fucking with her on the microphone.
Did you watch the segment afterwards?
I watched the segment.
At one point, you had to have at least gone through your head and said,
are they going to make out?
I would love that, or, like, God, I wish I could have a threesome with them two. Or you're just picturing them two getting it on, like, she's kissing
are
her
Are you
hand.
A fan of Paige now? A couple of
she's
weeks
kissing
ago...
kissing her hand, she's hugging her. I don't think Paige is that hot, but she's hot enough that with AJ, it's like, oh my God, AJ and another pretty good looking chick.
I think Paige is smoking.
I don't like pale chicks.
I know,
like
she's pale.
I hate the pale.
But dude, you put a tan on her.
Paige
is smoking, man. Paige
I will say this, and
hot.
I said it in the past, I think. Every once in a while, I get in the mood where I like a little gothic weirdo bullshit.
Are you getting in the mood?
I can get into that mode, but in normal boom, what turns me on kind of thing.
Oh, shit.
I don't like pale, gothic, weirdo, white girl, you know.
Sometimes boom gets
But every once in a while, hey, listen, every once in a while you want chocolate ice cream instead of strawberry.
Yeah.
So every once in a while,
I
want to
say, you want some Mexican,
yeah.
you want some chocolate, yeah. You want some white, what do you want?
Absolutely.
Bro. Speaking of chocolate, bro, how about the sexual chocolate chant?
They were chanting that.
Henry
That's
Liz,
right. And who was it on commentary? It said, Mae Young looking down smile.
Yeah, JBL said it.
Mae Young's the one that gave birth to a hand.
She's the one that came up with the sexual chocolate,
she
right?
gave birth to a hand
right.
when they were dating, and that was the gimmick. He was sexual chocolate. He was so sexual that even Mae Young liked him. And like, all right, even Mae Young, she's an 80-year-old broad. She'll like anything that'll fucking talk to her.
Real quick, man, we got one
in
minute. The eulogy of Dean Ambrose. Dean Ambrose was put through cinder blocks the previous week on Raw, so Kane and Seth Rollins come out. They give a eulogy for Ambrose last night.
Well, it was really a time filler, in my opinion. Until Reigns
really
came
was.
Out.
And then Roman Reigns. I mean, they were just going on and on about
he
how
took him out.
Seth Rollins was the leader of the Shield, and I
it
created
wasn't
the
for
group.
Me. Yeah.
Exactly. I created the group. I can ruin the group. I
Here
can
was.
Disband the group.
In two it's sentences. I created the Shield, and therefore I created everyone in it. And B, we took out Dean Ambrose. So that's pretty
out.
Much all he said, but it took
that's
him it. 10 minutes to fucking say it.
Finally, Roman Reigns came out, and everybody
was
like, "Well, wait a minute,
got to do that."
Well, wait a minute. Roman Reigns was the third member of the Shield, and Rollins is out there talking about, "I created this, I created that."
So it was organic.
So it made sense for Roman Reigns, Dean Ambrose. It was organic, exactly.
Yes.
So Roman Reigns comes out, makes the save. They beat him down for a while. He makes the comeback.
Sets up a handicap match for later in the show.
I thought a cool spot, man, was where he picked up the cinder block, right? They were about to put him through the cinder blocks. Picked up the cinder block, and man, that thing, when it hit the ring post, broke. I mean, the previous week, and I think the idea here was, the previous week, we put it up on the websites, it was styrofoam.
What is styrofoam?
Not styrofoam,
but
it was
doctored up.
It was doctored.
Doctored up cinder blocks.
So the idea here was to take a real cinder block this week.
Let's show them what this guy's head smashed through last week.
And give you the impression of, wow, Dean Ambrose, wow.
One
if
of
a
big
ring post did that to a cinder block, imagine Dean Ambrose's head.
You could see him struggling with the weight, and then when he threw it and watched it explode. But one of those big chunks almost hit Jerry Lawler.
Right, and a couple of fans.
Well, the fans maybe, but you hear Michael Cole immediately go, oh my God, are you okay?
Are you
okay?
That
was not, I don't, if it was, they got me on that one. I don't think that was part of the script, because immediately Cole's like, Lawler, are you okay?
Yeah, but Lawler was in the background. There was a camera.
But he didn't talk. He didn't respond.
Let him talk for a minute.
And then after a while, he just started talking about the angle, and I wrote in my playbook, I said, well, Lawler's talking now, so I guess he's okay.
Right.
And
right.
his face even looked red when they went to the camera shot of the announcement.
I didn't
table.
See that.
It was either this side or this side, but it was like right on the side of his face was red.
All right, we're over halfway.
It would be the left side.
We're over halfway through Monday Night Raw, so what we're going to do now, we're looking
at
we
got to blaze through it.
So here we're going to do.
We're
going to blaze through Monday Night Raw. When we come back on the flip side, we're going to do the high points and the low points.
It's going to be hard with that belt.
Give us 5 or 10 minutes to finish Raw when we come back from the break, all right? I told you
we got
to
make our pinky swear pact right here.
Yes. 10 minutes.
No matter how much we disagree on the Bella stuff or the Lesnar stuff, we can't spend a lot of time on it because we've got to get to them.
Yes.
I agree.
Give us 10 minutes when we come back from the break. All right. The entire rest of the show.
And we'll go
10
late if we have to.
We gotta go 10 late.
We'll give them an hour, like we promised, of rapid fire and calls.
We'll give you an entire hour of rapid fire. Just give us 10 minutes. Well, not an entire. We'll try to give you.
We'll give it our best. How do they even submit rapid fire? I don't even know.
You gotta tell. That's your plug. I had to tell them. Tell them how they submit.
Well, I guess. I mean,
I gotta put it up, right?
Yeah, put me on the spot. If you're gonna put me on the spot, I guess it's facebook.com/ don't crack that beer. You're moving. What the fuck?
Well, I'm cracking the
beer.
Let's
start over. facebook.com/ Ryan Clark, WZR.
You're gonna wait for me to start drinking and then fucking
get you drunk. Yeah, or facebook.com. No, not or. That's feedback. Just go to facebook.com/ Ryan Clark, WZR. Give us your questions and comments in hour number two, or answer them in a rapid style fashion. Interactive hour two. We're taking your calls as well. 518-712-3070. And even though it's not my number, I didn't screw up and say his personal cell phone. Hi, am I on the air? 518-712-3070. Facebook.com/ Ryan Clark WCR. You can call us. You can Facebook us. We will talk to you throughout the entire second hour. We want to hear from you, some bitches. Interactive Hour 2 and WZR TV. Get us into the break, brother.
You're listening to WZR TV Tuesdays.
You're goddamn right you are.
With Matt Boone and Ryan Clark. We'll be back.
Yes.
Right after this.
Goddamn right.
Do I have a good radio voice for that?
With Matt Boone and Ryan Clark.
We'll see you after the
break. We'll see you.
You gotta give him the peppy.
That's right.
We'll be back right after this.
Or the cutest, most adorable person in the world also be the most fucking annoying?
When he does not get what he wants, he just goes ape shit. And, he'll be toned down here in a minute. Get to our live chat room. Traffic's kind of low tonight.
I can be honest with you.
Traffic over the weekend was some of the lowest traffic that I've had in years. And I talked to another website owner, Frank from eWrestlingNews.com.
And eFightNews.
And eFightNews.com earlier today. We were talking about traffic for the weekend. And, man, it was just so low this past weekend that I'm thinking, what is going on? Is it the WWE product? Is it that people are away? It's the summertime. People are going back to school. A lot of kids out west are already back in school. They start school around August 16th, August 20th.
Everybody in Florida's already started.
Yeah.
I've seen the first day pictures for little kids.
See, up here in New York, they don't start back. I mean, they don't get out of school until about June 20th, June 21st, somewhere around there. They don't go back until, I think, September 6th or 7th. But other schools, either out west or down in Florida, they go back real early in August. Well, like mid-August, but then they get out in very early June or, late April, May.
Shirts. Why is the logo start here at your... below your tits?
It's the way we're wearing it.
And then the stomach. I keep trying to do this and pull it back and then do that right there, but
it's the way we're wearing it.
It looks like the logo is part of your belly.
If you want one of these beautiful t-shirts,
where can they go?
Go to email me, webmaster@prowrestlingscoops.com. webmaster@prowrestlingscoops.com. Send me $20 and I will ship it right out to you. We got to send a couple of t-shirts. I got his address a couple of days ago. The guy that was at Monday Night Raw. I think there was two guys
with
at Monday Night Raw. Yeah, so we're gonna ship them out a couple of t-shirts. Big ups to them for the WZR TV.
Big ups.
Not only that, but big ups. Big ups to him.
Shout out to my homeboy in the...
Big ups. All right. Never heard of big ups.
Yeah, I have, but not right? In your mouth, no.
Big ups to the people that, and by the way, if you bring a WZR TV sign to Monday Night Raw or SmackDown tapings, every little mistake you got to call me out on.
That was the only one tonight.
All right.
Did you put Rapid Fire?
Yes.
Okay. Still didn't grab your ashtray, though,
I know. No, I didn't, and I was going to do that before.
What are we doing here? Are we taking these now, or?
All right, we need to finish up Monday Night Raw, then we'll get into live phone calls and rapid fire for the entire hour numero dos. So,
all right, hang on, callers. Let's give us 10 minutes.
All right, so let's get back to Monday Night Raw. We left off with the Goldust and Stardust, the heel turn last night.
As we mentioned, it was the Dust Brothers versus the Usos. Tag titles were on the line. Rare title match on Raw. They give it the big formal introduction. Long story short, The match.
Good match between the two, right? Pretty decent.
They kept it pretty short. It ended via count out. Mm-hmm. With Uso selling his knee, and then after the match, Goldust got on the mic in a very heel fashion.
Crowd was dead for this match, by the way. But
well, it was at that certain point of the show, too.
Yeah,
it was kind of lagging.
Right.
Yeah, got on the mic in a very heel fashion, said, like, you know, the match needs to continue, whatever. That wasn't screwing up a word.
Alright, so he gets on the mic, right? He cuts a heel promo.
Yeah, basically a heel kind of promo. I don't really remember exactly what he said.
They cut a promo before they came out for the match, too, right?
The backstage goofy shit that they always do.
Right.
Yeah. You know, and that's worse than the Wyatt stuff in the sense of that means nothing. They're saying nothing.
Yeah.
But it sounds cool in a wacky way.
I guess.
If you like that wacky, goofy shit. But, I mean, it was a different time when Goldust first emerged in the 90s.
Right.
Shit isn't going to fly today. Not in the same format. Which is what they're trying. But long story short, heel promo, restart the match. But instead of restarting the match, they just beat down the Usos. Attack the injured knee of the Usos.
Yes.
Throw it on the pup, ring post, all that stuff. Very heel mannerism.
Jey Uso is the guy that... During the match, well, I just read. I didn't know either until I read it.
Yeah.
But Jey Uso is the guy that, you know, during a spot during the match, they made it seem like he had tweaked out his knee.
Yeah, I had that twice last night. I didn't know which fucking Matadores, Los Matadores guy. So I just said, Matadores, get beat up.
You can tell the Bella Twins apart, right? Bigger boobs. And
that's
one's got
quite obvious which one's which.
One's got a different face, too.
I don't need to look at the face. You look for the tits, and that's the one with
Bree's
the Nikki
Bella.
Bree's
got skinnier face, too.
Yeah.
I've noticed
Yeah, Bree's got, like, an anorexic almost.
Bree's hotter.
Nick, last night, did you think Bree Bella looked hotter than Nikki Bella?
Bree's hotter. Bree's hotter.
You heard it here first, guys. Anybody, I dare you, go back and look at a picture or video. Nikki Bella smoked Bree Bella in the looks department last night.
Bree's hotter.
And there's times where I'll agree with you on that on Total Divas, but no, not last night.
No. What are you, a boob man? Is that why? You like boobs?
I like legs. Boobs? Yeah, I'm a leg guy, but I like tits too. Who doesn't? But no, I don't like them. I like them skinny.
Yeah.
Dark hair, dark eyes, and skinny, and I like them small, like tiny.
Let's see, that's a chat.
But she's too skinny. There is such a thing as too skinny. She's too skinny, where you're like, you're going to break her.
I like it skinny, though, man.
I
like
do, too.
I like Bree Bella, like real skinny.
Nikki Bella's not fat.
No.
She's but fat right here, but that's
like,
a great
like,
kind of fat.
I think Bree's face is just pretty...
If you're going from here up, yeah, I'll give you Bree on that one.
Let's ask the chat.
But who cares about from here up? I'm talking from here.
Here's a Bree's hotter. Nikki was way hotter last night.
Of course, she was way hotter.
Well, this guy says Bree's with me, so there's going to be a difference in it. I bet it's about a 50-50 split here.
Not last night.
What do you guys think?
About last night.
Okay.
No, in general, I'll give you. There's times where they're. Yeah, they're all
what do you mean
twins.
There's times?
They're twins. They're fucking identical twins.
John Morgan thinks they've got a butter face. See, I think Nikki's
Are you
got
kidding
the,
me? Is that
Nikki,
what John Morgan said?
I think Nikki's got the fatter butter face, like my fat face. See how I got a fat face here?
I got this
I think
too
Nikki,
going on here.
I think Nikki's got the fat face like I do, and Bree's a skinnier type face, and I like Bree better. I don't know. I like Bree.
Shop Tone Man. I got to give him a shout. He says, I'll take them both. I'm hardcore. You know what that's from?
I'm hardcore.
That
I'm
was
hardcore.
Tommy Dreamer's quote. In the original ECW back in the day.
Yeah.
It was, I forget who, it was that Asian bitch and some other ace. And they're telling them, because they basically, one of
Me,
them.
Me, the Raven in the chat, I'm not into fake tits either.
One of them, if they look real, I don't care. One of them was into, one of them was dating Tommy Dreamer and the other one was this Asian chick. Long story short, it turns out in the storyline today, we're with each other.
Was it Beulah?
It was Beulah and the Asian
chick.
And I forget, the Asian chick was like a porn chick or a Playboy chick or a hustler chick or
right,
something.
Right.
So they ended up revealing in the ring during a promo segment that they were with each other. Because Tommy thought it was Raven that his girl was cheating on. And
right.
It turns out his girl was cheating with another girl. Fucking make out and Tommy's standing like, what the fuck?
So
Shane Douglas is also in the ring. Shane Douglas is also in the ring conducting the kind of thing a little bit. And Shane's kind of like asking him, what do you think? He's like... I'll take them both on. I'm hardcore. Grabs them both by their hair, and all three of them make out together.
That's awesome.
You know,
that's awesome.
So, and that's what Shop Tall just did. That was a great quote.
You see dub.
I was just watching the Paul Heyman documentary for the second time before we went on the air.
Man, I watched some stuff from ECW back in the day.
How have you not asked me for that Heyman documentary?
Where can I play it?
I'll give it to you.
Oh, I got to download it?
I can send it to you. I can upload it to your server. You can just download it.
The new one that just came out.
Yeah. 2 hour documentary. Uh-huh. Fucking amazing.
Is it?
Fucking amazing.
All right, no doubt.
Yeah.
All right, so back to Monday Night. Let's finish up so we can get into wrestling.
Quickly,
we told 10 minutes, right?
All right.
Oh, man. All right, Dolph Ziggler against Damian Mizdow.
Real quick, this is where they aired the Heyman Lesnar video.
That was awesome.
That was a great stuff. Video. Yeah, that was where at the end Lesnar says, it almost brings a tear to my eye.
They taped that last week of Raw, correct?
Yes, backstage right. at the Vegas Raw. The only thing I had a problem with was at the very end, and it was the greatest line of the entire video.
Okay.
Lesnar, like I did earlier, it almost brings a tear to my eye. He should have paused right there. Here's what he should have did. And here's what he did. Here's what he did. He said, you know, and he's talking about beating John Cena. You know, it almost brings a tear to my eye. Here's what he should have did. That's what he did. Here's what he should have did. You know, it almost brings a tear to my eye. But it don't. You know what I mean?
Right,
serious.
Right.
That should have been the punchline to that one.
Right.
But it was perfect. It was so good. And Heyman was great in it. Lesnar was great in it.
What do you think about
Lesnar's getting good.
Lesnar's good?
And I think it's because there are these pre-taped things where Heyman works with him. The same way he would work with guys in ECW and even in UFC.
But you notice whenever they're live, Lesnar does not cut any sort of promo. It's all Heyman. But when they can do the pre-tape stuff,
what the fuck was
Lesnar
backstage?
Gets a couple different takes.
What was it backstage where it was Heyman and Lesnar and Heyman? Oh, or Lesnar said something like, "Oh fuck!"
I know what you're
talking
about.
He had the funniest line ever.
You're right.
Oh god, it was so funny.
It was about about 2 months ago. I want to say going into maybe even 3 months ago. 2 or 3 months ago, it was back. They were backstage. It was Paul Heyman.
It wasn't a tell him Paul, but it was like, fuck, what did he say? It was so fucking funny.
He said
they gotta know what we're talking about.
Right,
I gotta
right.
get this or it's gonna bug me all night. And I know we're behind. Shit. It was like, Heyman, tell... fuck!
Paul, say something stupid.
That's it!
Something
that, was that. That was it! That
Who
was
said
it.
That?
Give him the credit.
Right.
Ranji!
Ranji! Always coming through. Ranji! Motherfucking Ranji, dude.
M-N. Who's the fucker that tweets us all the time?
Jorge. Romero.
George Romero. Yeah, yeah.
Jorge
Romero.
Jorge.
I don't know what it is.
All right, so back to Raw. What'd you think of Miz? The Miz came out real quick, cut a promo.
Sounds stupid.
Yeah, Miz comes out, cuts a promo. He says now that he's a Hollywood star, he gets everything handed.
There's some perks. One of the perks is I go to Disney World, they put me straight to the front of the line.
He gets gift bags, and he gets front of the line at Disney World.
Yeah,
Disney
and the other perk, I didn't hear gift bags. But yeah, one of the perks, I was at Disney World, they put me in front of the line. The other perks is you get a stunt double.
You get a stunt double. So he brings out Damian Mizdow.
Is that what they call him?
Damian Mizdow comes out and works at the Miz. He's got the hair spiked up.
Takes the glasses off right when the bell rings like the Miz.
It was poor Damian Sandow, poor guy.
And he makes it work so good, you would think they would be like, if he makes this work, let's give him something else to see if he makes that work.
Gotta get a rapid fire. Nikki Bella brings Brita Tears. I thought this was terrible. This went on and on and on. The acting here, okay, listen, the segment probably wasn't that bad. The acting between Brie Bella and Nikki. Nikki, I'll give her credit. She was pretty fucking good.
Thank you.
Okay,
that was my main point.
Nikki was pretty fucking good. But Brie, with her reactions, what? Why are you doing this?
Yeah.
Brie
was awful.
Brie was fucking terrible here, and it just went on and on and on.
It went for a long time.
When Nikki attacked her at the end, I thought that was cool. Jerry tried to get involved. The crowd chanted,
and she really
Jerry.
Yeah, like Springer too, almost like it was.
It was a fight on Springer. She was beating the shit out of Britt.
She was taking the mic and fucking smashing her with you could hear it. Like not the mic part where it goes thump thump. You could hear the guard that they put underneath the actual microphone. Like smacking her head,
and
like she was hitting her hard with
it. Let me say
just
this.
Just like last week when she smacked the shit out of her.
I think if the roles are reversed, okay, Nikki's out there playing the heel, and Nikki has the lines of, I don't care about you, you're not my family, those are pretty easy lines to say. Now, the reaction from Brie Bella, I thought Brie Bella, basically what I'm trying to say is Brie had the more difficult part of that segment where Brie is the one that has to react and fake cry and say, why are you doing this? Nikki is the one that is coming out and saying, I don't care, you're not my sister. That's easy to do. Brie's reactions were,
I agree in a sense, Brie had to do more acting.
Yes,
Nikki had that was, you'd think she, they said, just go out and say some stuff. No, that was scripted.
It was scripted.
And she had a lot of shit to say. If you go back and watch it, she said fucking 10 minutes worth of shit. She either had to memorize that or goddamn near bullet point memory. You know, and I don't think she's the kind of talent that they say, oh, well, here's your bullet point. Fill in the skeleton. Fuck that.
I got no problems with Nikki, bro. So I thought Nikki was good last night.
And that was the two arguments I had. The one was, everybody who puts over Stephanie McMahon is this great heel. Tell me what's different about what Stephanie does and what Nikki did last night.
Stephanie's got a better delivery, man.
No, she does.
Much better
but
delivery.
But in terms of being an effective heel.
Right.
Did you hate Nikki Bella during that segment? Fuck yeah.
Absolutely.
And here was the other main thing I said on Facebook, and I was trying to be very clear when I said it.
You know what ruined it? Brie Bella acting ruined it for me. That's what it was.
Brie's acting was horrible.
Brie was bad.
And I think if you know them...
And it went on too long.
If you know them... It went on way too long. Okay. I agree with that. If you know them from Total Divas, you know if you're looking at them in real life based on their Total Divas characters,
mm-hmm.
Brie is the baby face. Nikki's the heel. Nikki seems like the spoiled fucking like prima donna. And Brie's like
with Daniel Bryan on the farm doing stuff like that.
Save the world. Let's get fucking a car that doesn't. Let's use a solar powered car because gas pollutes the earth. Like all that kind of shit.
Right, right.
So she's the baby face naturally. Nikki's the heel naturally. But the main thing that I wanted to say.
They're gonna yell at us, man. But that's okay. Go ahead.
I know. We gotta talk about it. This is the big segment. This is
the main thing I wanted to say. Was, right. It wasn't good. I never said it was good.
Yeah.
And I was trying to make it clear in my Facebook post.
You were right.
Here's
right.
what I want to say, and it takes a lot of visual. When I do play-by-play, mm-hmm. TV's here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm here. Computer's here.
Right.
So for the most part, I'm here, and every once in a while I do this.
Glancing over.
When a really, I don't want to say really great segment, because then I'm saying it was a great segment. When a really captivating segment, when a really
intriguing,
thank you. I couldn't
think there, buddy.
I had captivating, and there was another word I had, and I couldn't think of the right word. I think I used gripping or biting or whatever.
But they had you looking
intriguing.
At the TV more
I
than the
computer. I stopped
computer.
Writing, and I'm like, wow, what's going on here?
Yeah.
And they had my attention.
Well, they had you. All
they right. had my attention. All right. They completely had my attention, more so than damn near anything on that show, maybe
well,
anything
then.
On the show.
Yeah.
Was it good? No. Yeah. The delivery was the scripting was the acting by Brie was holy shit.
What'd you think of the womb thing?
The length, the womb comment
thing,
was
a little bit overboard. Right?
It was overboard, but I think it was good.
Yeah.
I think it really
established
it was
that
a nice
they were
punch.
They were right.
Yeah.
Right, right.
A punch, but yeah, and
punch in the gut, you know.
Yeah.
Womb.
Metaphorically, or you know, and all that, and literally, but Nikki, I thought did a great job as a heel,
right?
Both verbally and physically.
I agree.
And I agree. Prior to all this, when it was Brie and Stephanie was obviously the leader of that program, but Brie was doing her part as the audience member, and you're
right.
such a bitch, and you know,
right.
and all that.
Right.
So that was good too. And Nikki, when she would do her stuff as part of it, sucked.
Yeah.
Last night, I thought Nikki, not great, but good. Brie, holy shit, that was bad, as far as her reactions and stuff.
Is that international right there? I'm sorry, I don't mean
Seven,
to cut
no,
you off.
No.
I think that's
Jackie.
Oh,
it is. No, it is.
Is it? Take it in international. I don't mean to cut you
Go
off.
Go ahead.
Caller, you're live on WZR-TV. What's up? Oh, you got it set up wrong, man. Hold on 1 second, man.
Oh,
we got to
we got to
fix our phone lines. Give us 1 second. I want to take him because he's an international caller. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so he's calling from overseas. I didn't want to make him. Hold on 1 second, dude. We gotta
Where
fix our phone lines.
On either one of them? I don't.
We gotta fix our phone lines real quick, and then we'll get back to you. Just give us 1 second.
I need to see one of these do something. Hold on. What the fuck?
I don't know what you're doing.
There's no audio coming from anything when I play.
No, I just heard him out of the computer up there.
Yeah, but I don't know which one to mute because I don't know which one.
Oh, well, mute.
I got the fucking window mute. Here we go. Hold on.
Sierra Hotel.
Mute this. Then we mute this.
Bear with us, man. Bear with us.
All right, he's good. Go ahead.
All right, get to our live chat room, WZRonline.com/chat. All right, let's try this again. Caller, you're live on WZR-TV. What's up?
Hey, what's going on, guys?
How you doing?
Let me turn it.
All right, I want to say something about Night of Champions real quick.
Okay.
I'm thinking, you know, they did basically got rid of the Reigns and Orton storyline, I think. And they're going to go with Rollins and Rollins and Reigns. And maybe they could do something with Orton, have some kind of a big segment or a big angle, maybe. I know there's rumors out there. Maybe you bring back Batista versus Orton.
We'll have to see what they do with I think it's Chris Jericho's highlight reel is returning next week
with
Randy Orton. So it'll be interesting to see what they do next week with Randy on the highlight reel segment. You know, I'm guessing that somebody's going to come out and interrupt that segment. I mean, probably Bray Wyatt comes out for Chris Jericho if they're going that route.
Yes,
going in champions
or Reigns with Orton. Or Wyatt.
Reigns. Yeah,
if
somebody
they're going
like
in that.
I think that's part of the reason that maybe they kept Orton off Monday Night Raw last night. You know, what do they have planned?
Makes a bigger impact when he does.
Right, exactly. Maybe they're going to... I don't know if they're going to change course next week or what they're going to do, but it makes sense. I mean, coming out of Raw last night, it makes sense to me to do Roman Reigns against Seth Rollins.
But we'll agree completely.
We'll have to wait and see, you know?
And I got one more thing.
Okay.
I think this would be a really good idea. You have Rollins versus Reigns one-on-one, and you have Dean Ambrose just interfere and go nuts during the match and beat up Rollins, and then maybe you have a brawl between all three of the Shields, and then at Hell in a Cell, if Lesnar's not going to be there defending the title, you could have a main event of those three going at it for the briefcase.
You know, it would be a cool idea to have all three members
of
the Shield going at it, but I think they have, as of right now, they've got Dean Ambrose and Roman Reigns aligned together, and Seth Rollins is kind of the...
with Kane and the Authority.
On the outside, yeah. So I think they want to keep Roman Reigns and Seth Rollins, although it would be pretty cool to see all three former members of the Shield in a triple threat match against each other, but I think they want to keep Rollins as kind of the outcast
and
of the group, and the other two...
And to his point, like you said, they may do a tag team match with Ambrose and Reigns.
Yeah.
I think it makes more sense because Ambrose is this free-for-all crazy guy.
Right.
And he just shows up at Night of Champions unadvertised and fucking attacks Rollins while he's fighting Reigns.
Right.
Like maybe Rollins and Kane start double-teaming mm-hmm. Reigns and Ambrose comes out of nowhere. Which one do you
want? All right, before we take the phone calls, the main event. The main event.
There was a handicap match, Rollins, Kane against Reigns. Reigns won,
Reigns
right?
won. Yes,
okay.
Yes.
And then the match was where he threw the brick that we talked about.
Threw the brick. We talked about that earlier. And then the Wyatt family against John Cena.
No. It was Cena and Bray.
Cena
was manhandling them, pretty much squashing them. We went to a commercial because the Harper and Rowan interfered.
Uh-huh.
When we came back from the break, it was automatically a 6-minute tag. Because before the break, Big Show and Mark Henry ran down to make the save for Cena. We come back from the break, an impromptu, as they called it, 6-man tag match.
Correct.
Which, in the end, Cena and the Big Show and Mark Henry team won.
They won.
The other thing to note is Mark Henry was supposedly going to be working on the thing with Rusev last week.
Yeah,
this
they
week, that
completely
wasn't even mentioned.
Scrapped that, right?
So
I thought the match between Swagger and Rusev was pretty good last night, man. There were a couple of
I didn't like the finish.
I didn't like the finish, but the match itself was pretty good.
I thought Rusev sold too much during that match.
Did you?
Yeah,
Swagger was going in and putting on the leg lock and the...
Patriot lock. Too many times, though. And it kind of weakens the finish if you get it on a guy three times and you can't make him tap.
Yeah, it's true.
Especially that one where he really had him for a while.
But Rusev's also a much bigger guy, and it's tough to lock that on.
But if you really rewatch that match,
Rusev
didn't really get a lot of offense until he got nothing but offense for the finish. So it was too much... He's supposed to be this unbeatable monster. He looked too vulnerable for too long, in my opinion.
So that's Monday Night Raw from last night, guys. For the next 30 to 40 minutes, we're going to be taking
rapid fire.
It's all your live phone calls and rapid fire. We'll give out the live phone number here right now, 518-712-3070, 518-712-3070, and rapid fire questions. You can go to facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR. Submit your rapid fire questions right now. It's the top post on my Facebook page.
Caller, you're on the air. What's going on? What's on your mind?
Oh, hey, buddy.
Oh, hey, buddy.
We're going to ask you about your ALS challenge, but you kind of already explained all that. I got a joke for you, though.
Go ahead.
Why'd the bicycle fall over?
Why did it fall over? I have no idea.
Because he was too tired.
He was too tired.
Oh!
Too
tired.
Tired. Too tired. What's this one? 727.
How do crazy
Will?
People get through the forest?
Go ahead, say that again.
How do crazy people get through the
forest? I have no idea, bro. How do they get there?
They take the psychopath.
The psychopath.
The psychopath. I like
psychopath.
It.
Psychopath. Is this Will?
Yeah.
It's fucking brother-in-law.
It's your brother-in-law?
Yeah. Fucking guy. My sister said she was going to bust her balls tonight. Anything else, you motherfucker?
I'm sorry.
What did he say? I'm sorry. Go ahead one more time.
I said, I just had to do it, man. We were going to call in and ask about your challenge, but you kind of called us out before we could. So.
Oh, did you, okay. Have you been watching the show? We mentioned it earlier. We're going to accept the challenge, just we can't do it on the air with the setup we have here. We're going to accept the challenge. Don't worry.
I see. Yeah, we've been watching the show, man. Okay. It's awesome.
Thank you very much, buddy. Miss you, miss my sister. Tell her I love her. Tell your little son there, Caden, I love him. Tell Tyler I love him. And I will see you guys soon.
Hi, Jamie. Hi, Tyler. What up, Will?
All right, man, without a doubt. Y'all have a good evening, man.
Right back at you. Love you, Jamie. Thank you for the call, Mr. Will.
Got the family members calling up.
Yeah. Go ahead, next caller.
Caller, you're live on WZR TV. What's going on?
Hey, guys.
Jacqueline! She might as well be family, what the fuck?
She's our family, man. We've missed
damn right.
Jackie is back. What'd you think about Rusev?
Maybe she doesn't want to talk about
Rusev. Maybe she wants to talk about Rusev.
But
she tweeted me about it earlier today.
Ask her about Raw and she could say
Rusev. What'd you think of Raw last night, Jackie?
Not too bad. I was pretty surprised that they put Rusev in the first match of Monday Night Raw. Like, usually he's like second, third hour.
I know. Tell me, well, I thought the match was pretty freaking good, though. I was just talking to Boone about that. I thought Rusev and Swagger was a really good match. Boone says that he disagrees. He thought that
I didn't like it.
Rusev oversold a little bit, but I thought it was. I mean, they gave it a good amount of time.
Yeah, they went through a break. Right?
Yeah, it was pretty good.
I believe so.
I think so, man. But it was a good match, you know.
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
I wonder who Rusev's gonna feud with next, because they didn't do a lot with him and Mark Henry last night. So I think that he should start feuding with Sheamus for the U.S. title if Sheamus beats Cesaro at Night of Champions.
They're going Sheamus Cesaro.
Mm-hmm.
But I like her idea, because what belt does Sheamus hold? The United States Championship.
Yeah.
Rusev's been battling USA the whole time. It makes sense on paper. I don't know why you're smirking. It does make perfect
this
sense.
This is like the United States. This is like me with
Champions
and John Cena at Night of Champions.
That's not even the same thing. That's not even the same thing. If he wins the USA belt, that's a fuck you to USA, which is his whole point as the Russian immigrant.
All right.
Night of Champions, you taking the name of a show.
Didn't he just win the flag match for Russia? Didn't he win a Raw match on Raw last night?
And his gimmick still not, do they still not drop the Russian flag behind him when he wins? Do they still not bring up on commentary and in backstage segments?
So the whole
Swagger let down America?
Yes, they bring it up all the time.
That's his whole gimmick, is that he fucks America. So how worse could you fuck America than winning the U.S. title?
At the Night of Champions.
That, you're a little too little with the name of the show there. That's just consequential. Anyways, Jackie, you were talking. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I apologize for Matt Boone's stupidity.
I think that they should probably try bringing back the European title as well, because the European title got disbanded. Wasn't it like 2001 that the European title was out from WWE, because I think they should bring back the European title.
The European title? Man, she wants to show, she's taking it one step further. What? She says she wants the European title back on Cesaro.
Yeah, because I remember
the European title
came in, and there was a big tournament over in Germany for it. I remember the final match was Bulldog and Owen Hart, and Bulldog ended up winning the European title. No.
I remember the Bulldog HBK stuff from back. How long have you been watching wrestling? God damn, that was a long time ago what she just brought up.
2001, right?
I've been watching wrestling since I was 2 years old, 1989.
89,
right? After WrestleMania 5.
Okay, so she's
born in 87.
That's
when I started.
What are you, 27, Jackie?
Yeah, birthday is November 25th.
All right, no doubt.
So she's 26, she'll be 27 this year.
So I know my wrestling history pretty good. I heard you guys talking about Tommy Dreamer and Violet earlier, and I remember that happening, and I remember who the other girl was. It was Kimona Walea.
That's
Kimona Walea, who was hanging out with Raven at the time.
She's right.
Did you Google that, Jackie?
You probably did, but that's
Jackie.
Did you Google that?
When it happened, when they got yanked off the air for that.
She's right.
Because I also read ECW autobiography about that too, because I'm trying to remember.
Wikipedia tells all.
I found a clip on YouTube a few years ago.
I got Jackie.
And I'm like,
Jackie.
I'm trying to remember how they got yanked off the air in certain states for that. So when the autobiography came out, I got it from the library and I read it. And I'm like, oh, now I remember that's how that happened.
Other than
I was reading it one day and I'm like, oh, shoot.
I can back her up. That's the Rise and Fall of ECW DVD, which was one of the most sold DVDs in WWE history. That's how I learned the story. I mean, I followed ECW as a kid growing up. I didn't know the behind the scenes of that particular angle, but I remember learning on the DVD that they lost some TV stations off of that angle because they didn't.
Yeah.
The lesbian shit.
Yeah, Illinois was one of them, and I think the other one was, I think it was Missouri. I don't know. I don't remember the third one.
All right. Well, she did Google it. They didn't mention what they lost TV wise on the documentary. They just said that they lost some TVs on that.
You are a smart woman.
She Googled it.
You are a smart woman.
She just exposed herself there. She had to have Googled it because they didn't mention any goddamn thing about losing Missouri or anything. They didn't specifically say what TVs they lost. Right.
Somebody made this comment.
We lost
as
some TVs
I'm remembering
on that deal.
It happening because I was watching ECW
for
a little bit. And then I was watching ECW for a little bit when it used to be on the air on a channel here in Michigan. And I was watching it, and I'm like, okay, it looks like they're getting sued. And I was also watching WCW at the time and WWF because Elizabeth was over at WCW managing Flair. And Sherry was over there too because I was wondering what was going on with them, and I would watch WCW for Raw would come on, and...
I agree with you, Jackie. I disagree with him snoring on that. I think if you're a real wrestling fan, I would watch Raw. If you're a real wrestling fan, she just brought up a lot of really cool historical stuff. And I told you, you could wrap it up however you want.
Yes.
Yeah.
Jacqueline, we appreciate the phone call tonight. We're going to talk to you next Tuesday night, correct?
Of course. I'll talk to you guys next week.
All right. We love you, Jackie. Be good. Be good. All right.
Thank you, Jackie.
We love you.
I'm sorry if I cut her off.
All right. We have got to share. She's a history buff tonight, huh?
I just got a newfound respect for her.
She's a history buff.
As a wrestling fan, I just gained some respect for her. She really knows her shit.
Or you could gain respect for some Google.
Or
some Wikipedia.
She might have Googled, but Jesus Christ, either she was reading it like a script or she read it and then called us and remembered all of it. That's still pretty good.
I'm pretty sure she had the page right up on her computer, and she's
saying,
"Oh, I think it might have been Missouri."
Be nice. Do you want to lose Jackie again?
No, I don't.
Because I don't. I love Jackie.
I love Jackie too.
All right, let's do some.
I
rapid
think it might have been Missouri.
All right,
here we go.
All right. That's an international caller right there.
Yes, take it. One more. Then we gotta get the. No. Shut down. All right, here we go. We've got to get to rapid fire tonight. we love you, Jack.
All right.
Yes, we're going to refresh the page, and then we'll get to rapid fire for the remaining time for 20 minutes.
We've got no more callers? Let's try this one more time?
One more time, and then we got to move on.
If it makes a noise, let me try and...
There's a lot of rapid fire, so we got to get to these.
Caller, are you on the air?
Hey, what's going on, Boone? What's going on, Ryan?
What's up, man?
Hey, quick thing. Where do you think they're going to go with Seth Rollins and the Money in the Bank briefcase? Because if Lesnar's champ, and I know he's not a part of the Authority, but he and Paul Heyman kind of had like a shake-hand agreement with them, I doubt he's going to cash in on Lesnar, and if he does, there might be some conflict there. And then you have like Randy Orton in the background where he probably would get pissed with the cash-in. And I always kept thinking maybe they would do a Randy Orton and turn him... baby face, where he finally says, look, I never got my rematch, and maybe he would cause Seth Rollins like, but where do you think he's going to go with the cash-in? Because if it's going to be on Lesnar, I don't see him cashing in.
No, I don't think it.
Thanks for the call, man.
That's what I'm saying, man. I mean, he's got, 1 year to cash in? A little bit over 1 year, right?
He's got a year.
They could have Roman Reigns. I mean, if they have Lesnar go on all the way to WrestleMania and then have Roman Reigns defeat him, Rollins would have an extra month or two because he wanted at the Money in the Bank pay-per-view so he could take it off Rollins. I mean, that would set up an angle between Rollins. Rollins and Reigns take it off Reigns. Take it off Reigns. But they could do that. But then they're not going to want to do that with Reigns defeating Lesnar. That's why I don't think that Brock Lesnar takes the title from now until WrestleMania. You've got a Rollins cash-in that's still coming up. Rollins isn't going to cash in on Brock Lesnar because he's going to lose.
Rollins ain't the guy beating
Lesnar. Rollins isn't going to beat Lesnar. I really think that Super Cena comes through at the Night of Champions paper. And then Rollins has got the money in the briefcase. What happens with that? Who knows? You know, I mean,
I don't know, that's a good point, though.
They could always put that match. They could put the briefcase on the line. You never know with WWE. They could say we're going to do Seth Rollins against Roman Reigns, and the briefcase is on the line, right? And Roman Reigns wins, and Reigns gets the briefcase, and all of a sudden, wait a minute, Reigns has got the briefcase. You know,
or Rollins somehow wins, and then Reigns comes out and beats him for the title as soon as he wins it. Like they could be. You never know. I don't know.
They could go any. All right, here we go. Rapid fire. I'll take the first one.
Well, the first one's William Armstrong
says, I heard that Kofi, Big E, and Xavier Woods are still a stable. Xavier. What's going on?
Xavier Woods.
I said Xavier.
Okay.
So anyways, basically what happened is they haven't been used on television in the last couple
Kingston
of weeks.
Kingston was on last night.
Kingston was on last night, but yeah. Not as part of the stable.
No. There never was a stable. They started to.
There was
kinda,
a stable.
No, there wasn't.
1 week on Raw, they came out and there was a stable. They all cut promos.
It wasn't a stable. It was guys like backing their friends or something. You know, they never.
They were all in the ring together. They cut a promo.
Yeah, but they never formed Unity.
They said we're going to band
Unity,
together.
I'm sorry.
Well, anyways, they cut promos.
Well, they dropped the plans either way.
Everybody thought it was going to be a stable. So people are saying that the stable's still together.
It's going to be the new Nation of Domination.
They appeared on Weekend Live Events together. So I guess they're appearing on Weekend Live Events. The thing with that is a lot of times for WWE Live Events, they will test things out to see how the crowd reacts, this, that, and the other thing. And they had the stable, at least two of them, teamed up over the weekend. So they kind of gauge the crowd reaction and see how the crowd reacts. And then if they react in a way that WWE likes, then they'll run it on television.
A positive
manner. They'll bring it to Raw and SmackDown. We didn't see it on Raw last night. So, yeah, I guess technically they're still together. No, but... they're together at house shows, and I think, you know, they may be together this upcoming weekend and the weekend after, and then we'll see what happens.
Anyways,
why are they keeping them together on house shows?
They're not.
I think they're gauging the reaction.
They did for a while. They dropped that angle from what I've heard, or that idea. I'm sorry.
Right, they dropped the angle, but then
the idea of putting them together. They dropped it. They don't want to do it anymore. Like they started having Big E working babyface again. They started having Kingston working Big.
And then you got to this past weekend, and out of nowhere, they were back together on live events.
I didn't read the report.
All right. So this past weekend at Weekend Live
Events. So, yeah, they could be testing it to see.
They're testing the waters, we'll see how the crowd reacts.
Maybe they've decided, let's see.
Let's see if the crowd reacts.
That's what
I'm saying. So we'll see.
But I think they should because the worst that could happen is, A, four guys that aren't doing shit are now doing something, and B, name a faction where at least one guy didn't come out of it with his stock higher than when he went into it.
Right.
You can't do it.
I know.
Because a faction always makes at least one person. So one of those four names, Kingston, Woods, Big E, or Xavier, R-Truth, would become, theoretically, a bigger star than he was going into it.
All right.
Brandon Scott Brown!
My man!
When will galleries be back on WZROnline.com? There's your webmaster. Go ahead and ask him. We've brought this up on the air before. If you'd like me to dog you out, I can right now.
Dog me out, then.
That was a gig I took as a favor from him when I needed money. Once I didn't need money anymore, and I started paying my own bills here with the money I'm making, it ain't my fucking job to run your site anymore. And we talked about this. I could spend the time doing your galleries and take away from the time making the money that I make. Let me ask you this question. How much money have you lost since I've stopped doing those galleries? Your checks seem to be not only about the same, but you got about $700 more last month from one particular company. Might have been a mistake. But you still got, you're still making the same money you always made. I could stop. I could make those galleries a part of my daily schedule and not do as much work over here and lose money over here to help you pretty much make no extra money doing your galleries for you. He gave me the gallery gig as a favor when I lost a job when I was in Florida. Now I've got fucking gigs. I pay my way and then some living here right now. And he can shake his head all he wants. He fucking knows it's true. Not only do I pay my way, I save the fucking day a lot of times. Bottom line, you opened this can of worms there, kid. I don't know what you want me to tell you, but...
You guys remember last week, we were on here, and I said to Matty Boone, I said, yo, you landed some good gigs. You got the MMA gigs, this, that, and the... And Matt Boone turned to me, and he said, brother, you were the reason behind
those gigs. You got me the one gig.
He said, you were not gigs.
You got me one gig. I said, one gig. I lost that gig until today when I got it back.
You got it back.
I agreed to do 10,000 pounds of work for shit money.
Some of the money coming into this house, not for the last half a month or so, but Boone, I basically recommended Boone, and as a favor, I had said to Boone, I said, first of all, I was paying you for galleries. I was paying you couple hundred dollars a month to do my galleries.
And then, WZR, yeah.
Then you came up here. Then you came up here, and we all went in on the bills together. And then, at the time you came up here, you only had one gig. You had the...
No, I had two.
Okay, all right. Well, I get you a third gig, okay?
No, I lost my second, and you replaced it with a new gig.
So the nice thing to do,
And you lost a gig that you could plug on, and did I not get you an even bigger gig to plug on? We don't mention that.
Right, but it doesn't ref shit.
Did I help?
It doesn't ref shit. But I appreciate it.
Beg to differ. I could swear I saw some IWZ links, and we won't even say the domain, that repped hundreds each post when we were looking at your traffic early on into you getting that gig. He wants to roll his eyes on that. You shouldn't have started this
shit. It was post-WrestleMania. Of course I'm going to get 100, 200 refs.
You want to go even back further and talk about...
Can I get some fucking galleries on WZR?
Can we talk about Dub Z?
Man won't give me galleries.
Skip the R?
So to answer your question, Brandon Scott Brown...
See, this is the stuff I love.
When will galleries be back on WZR?
He has no problem.
When this motherfucker decides to do them.
He has no problem.
When this dude decides to do them, his lazy ass and do them.
Lazy ass. Movie. You better take that back.
I tell you
or
what.
Or I'll quit my fucking job I just took today. That is fucking 10,000 hours of work with shit money.
The last 2 days, you got up that lazy... lazy ass.
I'm talking about the job I just accepted today that you got for me. Oh, and that now I have to do 10 fucking trillion pounds of work for shit money. Okay? You bring up all this personal shit about me. Like last week. Oh, I gave him money at the horse tracks. It was my money. I gave him money.
I explained that last week.
All right, but
I explained that. Don't
bring
this up.
No. That was an example. That was an example of you throwing digs at me about personal stuff, but you don't want me to tell you some personal... Do you want me to get into some personal shit about your work life?
Yeah, sure.
About how I made your whole fucking career?
I put you over for that.
All right,
you brought me into this business.
What the fuck are we talking
you
about?
You brought me into this business. All
right, so you got me a job.
Over
do I not have to do
on
work?
This radio show numerous times, you have brought me into this business.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so you got me a job. The same way I've gotten you about 20 fucking jobs over the years.
Appreciate it.
Okay?
I appreciate it. Can you do me some fucking galleries on WZRonline.com?
You know what?
Anthony Remy.
Is my plate not full enough?
Labor Day is next week.
Do your own fucking galleries. What the fuck are you even doing
there? Is my plate not full?
No!
Labor Day is next
week. Compared to mine?
Summer flew by
fast. Don't even try it.
Will Bully Ray sign with WWE? Will Bully Ray sign with WWE?
Will he?
Yes.
I hope so. Do I think so?
You know what?
Hey, I don't think so.
Bully Ray.
I hope so.
Bully Ray and Scott Velvet's guy. So I don't
he
care.
He can retire tomorrow and be a happy man.
If he quits TNA or signs with WWE.
Have him do your galleries. That motherfucker got a good enough life. Do some fucking galleries.
He's got it all right now with Velvet Sky,
give me
right?
some galleries of Velvet Sky, Bully Ray. You got the good galleries. That private fucking cell phone gallery. You know what I mean?
Marty
McElwee?
Akio or Sakata? What's he talking about?
Sakata. I have no idea. That's probably either some G1 shit or some Japan New Japan.
I think
tournament.
So. The Climax.
But I've heard a lot of the names. I don't remember Sakata or Akio.
Sakata in TNA? No, that's Sanada.
Sanada.
The X Division.
Yeah. Seiya Sanada.
All right. What's up next? We had Roman Mosier. What do you think is going to happen if TNA moves to that network? Talking about Velocity.
It's a whole different company.
It's a whole different company, and there's a whole lot less viewers that are going to tune in on a
weekly
basis.
And they're going to very greatly reduce. You think WWE reduced production costs and budget cuts? Right. Fucking forget about it. You're looking at half the roster you got now.
Yeah, yeah.
Half the star power, because anybody that actually is worth money, they can't afford anymore on that kind of a deal.
Well, we're saying Velocity is a worst-case scenario, too.
Yeah.
So, and don't think that
they don't have a better case scenario.
They're in talks with other networks. It's just, do those networks want them?
Not do they want them. It's, even if they do want them, what are they willing to pay for them? Because TNA lives off their... Oh, they don't make any money off pay-per-view.
They don't make any money off house shows.
They don't make any money off merchandise or licensing. Their whole entire fucking business is based on the rights fees they get from Spike TV.
From Spike TV, right.
And any deal, including the Velocity deal or whatever, would be a huge...
Talk about 50%, man. You're talking about 50%.
At least. You're talking about, didn't Spike give him like $100 million over 3 years or something? I don't know what the deal was.
Yeah,
I know it was lucrative.
Yeah.
Because they had expectations and they thought it would be a perfect building block with Bellator, which they bought into. They own Bellator. Right. Viacom does, not Spike.
Yeah.
What are we at, Tom?
Tom Nelson, man.
Tom Nelson says, hey guys, couple questions.
Uh-oh.
Do you listen to all 5 podcasts online in addition to Piper?
This guy does.
Not all 5. Fuck no.
Pretty much, right?
No, I'll tell you after I read it. In addition to Piper, also Goldberg, Bill Goldberg, Austin, Steve Austin, Ross, Jim Ross, and Jericho, Chris Jericho. And just curious, how was the curb stomp from Rollins to Ambrose PG? It was PG. I mean, it wasn't that violent. I mean, there's a lot of violent shit they do.
There's from time to time they go off the PG.
Yeah,
script.
If you want
to
go through the majority, there's plenty of non-PG violent acts that they do.
The majority of shit is pretty PG on WWE. You listen to Austin's podcast.
I listen to Austin almost religiously. Jim Ross, pretty much every time when we're done and we fix the studio back to my room.
Those are your main two, and Howard Stern, but he's not a wrestler.
No, podcast. Okay. Yeah, and if Jericho has a good guest, I'll listen to that.
Okay.
I've never listened to any Goldberg shows.
What about Piper?
Never listened to any Piper shows.
No Piper?
I love Piper in the ring.
Yeah.
I think I listened to his when he had a podcast before this big podcast craze, and it was called Piper's Pit Then too.
Yeah.
It's not good.
Really?
He's too much into himself and he tells the same stories and he's just too much of a mark for himself. I've been accused of.
Did you see his comments about Ric Flair? He called Ric Flair an asshole over the weekend.
Interesting. It must have been. It was a report from a fan that was at the show. It was in Ireland. Yeah. The show was in Ireland, so all the notes we got were from a fan. One fan in attendance.
Right, right.
I'm telling you right now, if I'm there, he had to have been joking. It's well known that Piper and Flair love each other's nuts.
He did
more
say,
Flair than Piper.
He said Ric Flair.
Yeah, I love the guy.
He's an asshole, but I love the guy.
I don't like being around him.
I'll be honest. I won't mention him.
Go ahead.
Roddy. You know Roddy. I've had a past.
I've interviewed him 6 times.
I had a past with
you.
Roddy. I think Roddy. There's things going on.
Say it.
There's things going.
Does
on.
Does Piper hold back?
No, he doesn't.
So, do I hold back?
No, but I don't want to
say
somebody
it.
Could go out and I...
Nobody's reporting shit. Say it.
No.
Can you believe he's bitching out?
Paul, I'm bitching out. The past with Roddy Piper and the whole Twitter thing back and forth?
We all remember it.
I don't want to accuse somebody
of... All the kid stuff?
No, I don't want to accuse somebody of doing something that I don't have any confirmation that he may be doing. So
I don't know what you're talking about.
Paul Velasquez.
Guarantee I hear it all fair, and I'll be like, you just fucking said it.
I'm not going to. It involves. This one's for you.
I just read the last one.
Paul Velasquez.
The podcast one.
But this says, hey, Boone.
Oh, hey, Boone. Okay. Hey, Boone. Who you got for this Saturday's event, Henin Burrell or TJ Dillashaw? Also, what do you think of Cain Velasquez versus Fabricio Verdum? The last time Kane was on the injury shelf and fought, he got knocked out by Junior Dos Santos. Do you see something similar in nature happening again? By the way, Ryan Clark takes some notes from the points that Boone makes.
Oh, Jesus.
He says, God forbid anybody puts me over.
Well,
Jesus Christ.
Wait a minute. So give me your UFC predictions.
All right.
Who you got, Boone?
Henin Burrell, Dillashaw's a tough one. Because if you look at their first fight, Dillashaw, like, owned his life.
You got a pen and a piece of paper over there?
It'll be easy to remember.
Oh, okay.
Dillashaw owned him. It wasn't like a close fight. He fucked his whole life up and then knocked him out, or TKO'd him and beat him.
Right.
But, supposedly, Henin Burrell, who fights it, I always screw up bantamweight and featherweight. I think he fights at 135, let's even say 145. He was supposedly 196 when he went into camp, which means he had to lose 50 fucking pounds damn near. for the fight, and he also had an injury he was working through, and obviously you don't take a challenger like TJ Dillashaw seriously. It was one of the lower ranked challengers.
Hold on a second. Boom just read this dude's comment, right? Which is all good, and then at the very end...
I said that. P.S. More MMA talk.
Oh. More MMA talk.
What did you think I said?
My bad. I thought I said no more MMA talk. Oh. My bad. Okay. Go. Continue on.
Anyways, my prediction... Oh, God, I want to take Burrell, but I can't... You can't pick against Dillashaw after that fight.
I'm taking Burrell.
You know what? I'm going to play it safe. I'm taking Burrell, too.
Taking notes.
But, all
take
right.
Take notes.
Well, no, you can just remember. I agree with you. Right. Verdun, right. Velasquez, that's pretty easy. Who do you got?
Velasquez.
Okay. You're up.
All right, no doubt. Gene Cullum. Don't you think it's funny how WWE has tried to condition us to think that WCW was this horrible wrestling show that had no viewers until the NWO, but yet they are showing the weekly ratings on the Monday Night War, and WCW was never more than 0.02 or 0.2 off in the ratings. They're right. And they even said, you know, there was a promo that aired during Raw last night that said, listen, we either got to beat these guys or we're going to go out of business. Classic Triple H.
I'll do you one better. Before the Monday Night War, before Nitro existed, WCW do Clash of the Champions.
Right.
They would do insane ratings on Clash of the Champions. Mm-hmm. Their Saturday Night Show would sometimes be WWE's show.
Yeah.
Like, even, and this is before Ted Turner bought the company, even.
Yeah.
So, I mean, they always did good TV ratings. They never sold on pay-per-view, ever, WCW. The Piper Hogan thing sold, the Sting Hogan thing sold, and I think that was about it, to be honest.
How many weeks did WCW beat Monday Night Raw?
Oh, God.
Do you have the exact...
83 weeks. So it was 83 or 86.
It's like a year and a half, right?
It was over a year. Okay. It was almost 2 years. It
almost
was like
two?
A year and a half.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
All right.
A little, maybe a little over. But yeah, right around there.
Yeah.
Right. And I mean, they not only beat them, they fucking dusted them.
Huh?
But at the same time, if you look at the numbers, it wasn't like Raw was doing shit ratings. They were doing pretty much what they do now.
Right.
But Nitro was doing like a 5 or 6 on top of that. So you had 6, 9...
God, do you remember the days?
You had like 9 million fans watching wrestling, switching back and forth. There was times where they would not beat Monday Night Football, but I think they would be like really competitive.
Right there. Dude,
if you added it up.
There was days, like, you guys see the Raw ratings.
If you added it up, let me make sure that's clear.
The new viewers, like the younger viewers, they see the ratings right now, and they see like a 2.9, 2.8, 3.0, 3.1. That's what they're used to. Back in the day, during the Attitude Era, I remember reporting things like 6.0, 5.9, 6.1.
And then the other one,
which
was
like,
going head to head, so it wasn't the same people.
Right.
It wasn't like, oh, well, 2.3 million of this,
no,
6 million.
They were
was
both on Monday night.
It was at not only Monday night, same time.
Same time.
So if this got a 6.1 and this got a 4.8,
4 point something,
you're looking
at
10 point whatever I just said. I don't remember the point.
So that was back in the day. You guys would be seeing Raw ratings that were like a 9.8, 10.1, things like that.
You're talking
now,
for one show or combined?
For combined shows.
Yes, yes. Combined, they would compete with Monday Night Football. There was as many wrestling fans
watching
on Monday nights as football fans. And football
and now,
is the national sport of America.
And now you're talking from two combined shows, but this is wrestling fans in general as a whole.
Yes.
Combined shows.
Theoretically, when WCW closed, you should have taken those.
You should have taken those numbers, and you should still, to this day, be up around 5.0, 6.0, somewhere in there. You should be up around there. Get down to like a 2.8, 2.9, 3.0,
3.1.
It's
bad.
All right, what do we got?
What do we have? Benjamin? Norsworthy? That's a hard name to say.
Norsworthy?
Why did Vince McMahon sour on Bo Dallas so fast? Love the show.
You know, there's been a lot of reports out, but like Bo Dallas last night, they put him in a brand new feud. They had him cut a backstage segment.
He did it last week, too.
Well, he's going to be in a feud with Jack Swagger, right?
Not brand new, but yeah, new feud, and he's only lost the one match. I think that the whole reason that he lost that match to R-Truth, which... There was a million ways they could have done it. Other than that, was
you
to
brought this up a couple of weeks ago.
Get rid of the streak.
Point.
Don't have people focusing on that
point.
Streak like Goldberg and WCW, because once you finally lose, that's your whole gimmick, is that you've never lost. So
right.
Once you lose, it's like your gimmick's over.
Right.
You're a loser now.
Exactly.
So they wanted to, and then Bo Dallas, and I don't know if the announcers were told to do it, but the whole gimmick behind Bo Dallas was he's on a winning streak. He
doesn't
lose.
Well, it was JBL mostly. It was JBL.
And they say JBL is the voice. Vince McMahon is JBL.
Vince McMahon is plugged into JBL.
As far as the asshole comment, not the asshole comments, but the
political stuff and
furthering the storyline, yeah, comments.
Well, and Michael Cole
from JBL.
Right.
No, Michael Cole, yeah, is the other side of the coin, which is Vince's, maybe, like, Vince has the devil on this shoulder and the angel on this shoulder, and the devil goes into JBL's ear.
Correct.
And the angel goes into Cole's ear.
Exactly. That's
just
a
guess.
That's a good, that's a good, what's the
analogy.
Analogy. All right, we had Jason Hansen. What do you think of the majority of the IWC, the idiots whining and complaining? He says idiots whining and complaining, but internet wrestling community.
It was his joke.
Yeah, of course it was his joke. Literally bitching and moaning about the smallest things in the world of pro wrestling and always jumping to conclusions. There's absolutely no patience when it comes to storylines and the progression, etc. Why are the IWC fans always nitpicking and so fickle?
I can't believe you got through that without a fucking single error. I looked at that fucking paragraph, I said, I'm going to have a field day fucking with him on this one. You didn't fuck up once. Go ahead, give your opinion on that, and then I'll give
it. You know, the IWC has always been like this, all the way back into the 90s when I first started doing this.
You say it every week.
Always been like this.
They're quick to fucking jump on you. Oh, you're wrong!
But you know what?
You're wrong! What?
Here's the thing, and we always blast the IWC. Boone and I?
We are the IWC.
Boone and I come on here every week, and we nitpick and nitpick shit that happens on Monday Night. It's our job, obviously. It's our job, but the fact is that some people, things happen on programming, and they just throw a fit. You guys have seen the videos online. We'll give them the benefit of the doubt, but you and I, we do it as well. We come on here and nitpick the little things on Raw.
I think I know what he's saying in the sense that they'll take the tiniest fucking thing and make it the... Why is Ziggler losing? Who cares right now?
Right.
You put him in a position where he shouldn't be losing, then yeah, why is he losing? Right now, the way his character is positioned, does it matter if he loses? Does it affect him really?
It doesn't.
No. Now, he should be this, based on his talent and his ability, of course he should be.
Right.
All right, my sister.
Oh, boy.
Jamie Rush. Did you read this ahead of time? Do I know what I'm reading?
I have not. I just saw the name and I pointed to it.
My sister, Jamie Rush, says, well, y'all already brought it up, so no reason to call in now and look stupid, but y'all better do a badass ice bucket challenge, or don't forget, I nominated both y'all. Give me a shout-out. Love you guys. Keep doing awesome shows. I got a living room full of people watching. We're going to do it, right? I'm committed to doing it.
We're doing it this weekend.
Okay, we'll do it this weekend. We can't do it here.
I got a big
bucket.
We need
to be outside. Yeah.
I just got those buckets that I brought in here. We'll
do it.
Big bucket.
I'm done. Right. And I've got a creative way, because everybody tries to put their little creative spin on it.
Right.
As opposed to just, I'm ready to do my challenge, I nominate, blah, blah, blah. Let's do it. And that's what she did, by the way. I think I've got a little storyline I can do.
Yeah.
Like a little funny comedic segment, like a SNL sketch or something.
Boone comedy, folks. Boone comedy.
I'm not saying it's going to be funny, but it'll be interesting to watch. Oh, that's what I think.
Can't wait.
I'll give you my opinion. I'll tell you off the air. But I think I've got a funny way to do it.
Am I involved?
Yes.
Okay.
You and your sister are involved. Because we need some, or Haley. We need somebody else besides me and you.
Excellent.
And those were the two that came to mind.
We got it. Can I beat your ass when we do it?
I'm the one who looks stupid in it.
Oh.
So, you look like a fucking champ.
Yeah?
Whoever the other one we pick looks
Does
funny.
Does it involve a slap in the face?
No, but it involves me looking retarded.
All right.
Okay.
I'd love to be able to do
I don't that. Mind being the ass, showing my ass as a heel.
Nothing would make me feel better than to be able to dump.
I'm going to be the heel.
And then just bitch slap
you. You smack me, I'm going to knock you the fuck out. But, yeah, you're going to be the baby face, and you're going to look like the champ, and I'm going to look like the guy that just got his fucking, oh, man, Boone got fucked on that one.
Yeah?
Is what people will think. If I don't say what I just said now and reveal that it's all planned, but not everybody that will
Nick
see
Dodge.
Us watching this right now.
Do you see the storyline of Brock Lesnar where something happens at Night of Champions where he wins and then gets fired the next day at Raw leading to the WWE Championship Tournament? There's got to be a way to write Brock Lesnar off television without him losing the title. I agree with you on that. I think that they need to get Brock Lesnar as champion going into WrestleMania. Basically, does Brock Lesnar win the title at Night of Champions somehow?
He's already got the title. Does he retain the title?
Yes. The following night on Raw, did they do an angle where he's somehow fired?
If he loses the title, or
no,
either way?
No, he retains the title coming out of Night of Champions.
And then somehow gets fired.
And then somehow on Monday Night Raw, well, he would just destroy Cena, or he would be so brutal.
No, I don't
he'd
I don't
be so brutal on John Cena that the authority could say,
you
went overboard last night.
Reverse the decision. You're suspended. Maybe.
You're suspended.
Suspended would even explain why he's off TV for
you
a
went,
while.
You went way overboard last night at Night of Champions. There's nothing else that we have no other option but to suspend you. You're
no. Oh, if you're asking me, I don't see
that's
anything.
That's what he's asking.
Okay. I don't. But you agree with him, I thought.
No, I don't. I'm
oh,
asking
okay.
you.
Okay. No, I don't see anything like that at all.
Matt Johnson
says, I know Ryan shit all over this segment on Face. I think he means Facebook. Last night, as always, LOL. And I know I'm probably in the minority, but I actually thought Nikki was pretty good on the mic.
I said that earlier, Matt.
At least, yeah. No, we both agree with that. Yeah. At least a much better improvement from last week. Again, I agree. The segment by the end was entertaining as well. Do you think this angle will spill onto Total Divas? The whole reason this angle's happening is because of Total Divas.
The entire reason
we're seeing the Bellas like this
right.
is because of the Total Divas show. That's the entire reason they did it.
Absolutely.
That's the only reason this is happening right now.
And not only that, but I thought Nikki in her role last night, she was really good. It was Brie with her acting.
I wouldn't say really good.
She was good. She was good last
she was
night.
Much better, if you want to use the word much better than in the past.
Much better or much better looking?
She was much better looking, too, than usual.
So much better and much better looking.
That's how dressed she was last night, dude. I wanted to jerk off and stop play-by-play right then and there. Pump, 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 pump. Blah! You know what I mean? I wanted to...
No.
Is it me
Jesus,
or you?
Jesus, John Morgan. You take
Here, I'll take
Look
it.
At this fucking three-pager.
John Morgan, great guy.
he
says,
a good dude.
What is WWE going to do with...
Well, he's a great dude until he recommends us for the ALS challenge, right?
My sister did, too.
All right,
I'll read it quick. All right. John Morgan says, what is WWE going to do with Bray Wyatt now? Like you guys have said, his gimmick is going stale and getting squashed by Super Cena. Almost always spells a death sentence for any superstar's push. I'm starting to worry that Bray is going to go the way of Ryback in the sense that he received all this big build-up, all this big hype, and had all these big wins over big names, but then WWE fed Ryback to Super Cena, and after that he was buried into the mid-card. In fact, as far as I can remember, Ryback has never even held a WWE championship, and so far, neither has Bray. Are we seeing the slow bury of Bray Wyatt?
I agree. John Morgan.
That's why he's a good guy. He's smart.
John Morgan, I agree with you. Where do you go from John Cena? He's already had John Cena.
No, he's talking about Bray Wyatt. Are they burying Bray Wyatt?
He's already had a feud with John Cena.
Yes.
Okay, he's already had that feud. Then he goes Then he goes into Chris Jericho a step down. Okay? We say week after week, it's stale. Where Jericho leaves after Night of Champions.
I don't say week after week.
So he's been with Cena up here. He goes to Jericho. Jericho leaves. Cena's on to another feud. Then he takes another step down.
Yeah, but
then he takes another step. And
when
we
you
see
go
the
to,
same thing every
All right,
week.
Well, the whole argument there is they rushed him to Cena. Because who's...
Okay.
Okay, Cena's here, like you said?
Coming out of Cena.
Cena's here, like you said, right?
Yes.
Who do you go above Cena? Who's above Cena?
Nobody.
So obviously, the only place to go is down.
Right.
But the idea is to maintain as much of his credibility as
yes,
you can.
Yes, the idea is coming out of the Cena feud is to keep him on the
strong.
Same level.
Yeah.
Not the same level, but...
Keep him strong.
At the top.
Yes.
At the top.
As
with,
a legit player.
And they're not doing that, man.
They did. They had him.
Well, they had him with Jericho, right.
And Jericho's a legend, you know.
What,
Surefire Hall Flamer.
What happens after
Flamer.
What happens after Jericho, bro?
I don't know.
I think that's what John's saying.
I had the same question about Brock, which we never got into. And I talked to you about this last night. I said, all right, and everybody knows my opinion. I think Brock retains at Night of Champions, and he lasts all the way to WrestleMania, and then Roman Reigns finally is the guy that saves
shit.
The day and is the guy that ends Lesnar's dominant run. That's what I've been saying for weeks. But my big question is, how do they get there? But
right.
with the Cena factor is, he just squashed the top guy in the company, the biggest name, the top guy in the company, the face of the company. Who do you put in with Lesnar after that, and how do you book a match with Lesnar versus X? Name any guy you want.
It's got to be Reigns, bro.
Okay.
It's got to be Reigns.
But no, that's not till Mania, though. He's not the next guy. So anybody else other than Cena, They're already, like you said, with Wyatt.
There's nobody.
It's a step down. How do you book a Brock Lesnar match to where anybody else is even justified being in the ring with him because they're not as big as Cena? And B, how do you book the match in the sense that he squashed the best guy in the company? How does anybody else even put up a fight?
I don't.
If this guy can't even fucking land one move on him, how does anybody else justify getting any offense in on him? And if that's the case, how do you book a match with Brock Lesnar from now on? I don't know how they do it. That's where last week my big thing was. I don't agree with the course they're taking, but because they've started the course, you can't stop now.
Right.
You know what I mean? And the only way to really blow it off is the Reigns make him the star as the guy that ends. You know, go ahead.
I want to show you something. We're 12 after. We're going over a little bit tonight. I just want to show you. That's what we got to go through.
Fuck
so,
me. All right, let's go quick. Let's go.
Thank you, man. All right, here we go. And it's me too. We gotta take the rest of these pretty.
God, I thought it was there, and then you keep going up. All right, go ahead.
Down. All right, brother. All right, here we go. All right, AJ.
Where's SmackDown tonight?
They're out on the West Coast.
Okay, thank you. That's 3 hours.
We're okay.
Okay.
It's not, though, because they've been on the West Coast the last couple of weeks, and they're taping SmackDown because Main Event's on the
play. Okay.
So SmackDown's going to be out here in about
20 minutes. We still got about 20 minutes.
About 20 minutes before SmackDown. So, all right, we're going to go about another 10 minutes. We're going to try to get through as many of these rapid-fire questions.
Let's go.
You got to give us credit, though.
They got it. All
right, AJ Clark, last week on Monday Night Raw, Randy Orton said that Reigns won the battle, but he won't win the war. Is WWE continuing the Reigns-Orton feud? Because I thought it was supposed to be Reigns, Triple H at Night of Champions. Ryan Clark's biggest fan. You know, I think they may have changed things. They kept Randy Orton off Raw last night. He's going to be on the Highlight Raw. The next week's Raw with the Highlight Reel segment, Randy Orton, Chris Jericho, it's going to be interesting.
I didn't hear anything about Reigns, Triple H at Night of Champions. But, okay.
That was the original plan. That was a couple of months
maybe
ago.
Maybe months ago, yeah. Months ago. That's long been changed. Brandon Scott Brown says, what do you guys think about Prince Devitt and Kevin Steen in NXT? And awesome. Do you think WWE will bring Jacob...
Goodnight.
Bring the Jacob Goodnight character to TV?
See no evil. Kane.
I've never seen the movie. Wow, yeah. Okay.
I haven't seen the
movie. No, they're not bringing that character to TV. What the fuck?
Well, they did the mirror thing a couple of weeks ago with Adam Rose.
No, that was from Oculus.
Okay.
You're right. But as far as Steen and Devitt, I heard, Devitt's allowed to keep the body paint, and there's even talk. There's been speculation about Steen and Devitt as a tag team.
Right.
But anyways.
Jay Mullen, I noticed something of interest last week during Heyman's promo. He kept putting Cena over and clearly mentioned that if I could, I'd make John Cena a Paul Heyman guy. Do you think it's possible that Heyman screws Lesnar inside Cena, similar to what he did in 2003 when he screwed...
When he screwed Lesnar in 2003 for Big Show. No.
It's a good idea you bring up, but
It is a very interesting idea, but right. No, I don't see that happening.
Vincent
Nugent, Acer, says, with the recent addition of Brock Lesnar versus John Cena for the WWE World Heavyweight Championship at WWE Night of Champions 2014...
Say that five times fast. Go ahead.
I will do it if you want. With John cashing in his rematch clause against Brock, do you guys think WWE should add a stipulation to their match? If so, which one? I personally suggest an I Quit match. What are your thoughts?
What do you think about that? A stipulation?
It is hard to do that rematch without a stipulation, in my opinion. How do you justify, he beat me in a regular match, so now we're going to do another regular match, and I'm going to win this time?
Right.
I think even with Cena doing that darker side shit, too, it would make more sense to make no DQ, I Quit, whatever.
Right. Jose Lewis, your thoughts on Taya Valkyrie and Ivelisse Velez. NXT Divas.
I don't know them.
I'm thinking you're talking about NXT Divas. I don't know who either of them are.
Names vaguely sound familiar, but yeah, I don't know who they are. Paul Velasquez says, do you think Bray Wyatt... I love how I have to read all these fucking paragraphs.
They are long, right?
Paul Velasquez says, do you think Bray Wyatt will face Sheamus or Ziggler after their current feuds? Bray Wyatt will face Sheamus or Ziggler after their current feuds? They could. I mean, who the fuck knows?
Who's he going to face after Cena Jericho? That's what we just got on top of.
Sheamus, I could see. He's kind of... Ziggler doesn't seem to be...
Ziggler's got the IC title, though.
Yeah, but I don't
Bray
think
with
you
the
want,
IC title.
I don't think you want Bray fucking around, because that title's almost like a... Less than a...
Which is sad. The IC title doesn't...
But with Lesnar as a champ, and that champ off the road, like you said, maybe they could build the IC and US title to mean more.
Possibly.
They could take that opportunity to make those belts mean more again. I think Wyatt... this is Velasquez.
Paul.
Yeah, Paul Velasquez says, I think Wyatt's promos are good, and many actually have a meaning behind what he's saying, but I can see how people cannot understand it. Do you think they're going with Reigns versus Rollins at Night of Champions? Sure looks like it. Also, been seeing lots of Reigns work on Raw and SmackDown, and he's improving a lot on his promos, his facial expressions, etc. So that's a plus, and as long as he keeps it up, he's going to be a big star come WrestleMania 31.
We haven't seen much of Roman Reigns on the microphone in recent
weeks. On SmackDown, he supposedly had like a moment.
Oh, on SmackDown? Okay.
He had like this moment where like he broke character for a split second.
Did he?
I heard Meltzer say that.
Yeah.
But
I didn't watch it. Yeah, so I didn't watch it. All right, Christopher Brown, what was up with Ryback posted last night? Basically posted a tweet on Raw and him taking it down this afternoon. Is he taking time off with some undisclosed injury or what? By the way, I had a couple of video hiccups about 25 minutes into the show, but it seems fine now. Sorry about the hiccups on the live stream. Hopefully we're all right. Yeah. Real quick, Ryback posted a tweet. If you know anything about Ryback and his tweets,
he fucks with everybody.
He puts stuff up and then he deletes them. And then he puts it up, then he deletes it.
He likes to fuck with you.
Back and forth. Who knows?
The tweet said, I need to go away for a while to fix some things or something like that. Basically, that was the.
Sorry, punk. So everybody thought, well, wait a minute.
And it was a picture.
Right.
Of him standing tall. It was two action figures.
Right.
Ryback, CM Punk. Ryback action figure standing tall on this thing, and Punk is laying flat on the ground, and it said, sorry, Punk.
Right.
I took it more of as a fucking...
Larry Smith got the same question, Ryback leaving WWE. I think
he wasn't on TV last night, but no,
I think so.
He's always fucking around on Twitter.
See what happens to SmackDown and Raw next week, but I think he's fucking around.
Vincent Nugent, Acer, says, have you guys watched any ALS Ice Bucket Challenge videos online? If so, what are your thoughts on people doing them, including professional wrestling? We've already talked about Howard Stern, and I revealed my favorite one's Bully Ray Sky. What was your favorite one?
The only thing, I'm going to have to...
Vince McMahon, Stephanie
Vince
McMahon.
Was pretty good. Stephanie was good. Pretty good with the Four Horsewomen.
Yes.
Listen,
EatFightNews.com, more on Four Horsewomen.
The only problem I have with it is I wish more people would say, by the way, I nominate these people, but by the way, can you please go to ALS.org and donate? And not enough people are saying that.
Maybe celebrities don't. Almost every wrestler I have said, you should donate. And they even mentioned because they're putting themselves over. Oh, and I'm going to donate, but I'm doing this too.
Oh, man. Allie Adair. Hey, guys, it's Taz Maniac from the chat room. Today is my birthday.
Happy birthday, Taz Maniac.
2 a.m. in the UK,
Mr. Allie Adair.
The question I have is, do you guys think... you guys think was or is the most overseas? Who do you guys think was or is the most overseas wrestler in history? So not the Americas, e.g., Mexico example.
What the fuck is he? Mexico. Who is the most overseas wrestler?
I don't know what
does that even
about.
Mean?
The most
who is the
overseas?
Best wrestler overseas? Is that what he means?
Prince Devitt's in WWE, right?
Devitt, yeah. Who's the best wrestler overseas? Yeah. Kenta? I don't watch a lot of that shit. Any of that shit, let me be honest.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, buddy. Arturo Velasquez Jr., in your opinion, guys, is Roman Reigns ready to be a main eventer despite the obvious lack of promo skills? Right now, no. Is he well on his way?
WrestleMania 31?
That's a year from now. Well, not a year from now, but, several months, 8 months, whatever it is. Yes. Maybe by then. We'll see.
Vincent Nugent. Man, we gotta get through these.
Vincent Nugent, what do you guys think about TNA Impact Wrestling?
Last one for you, Vincent.
What do you guys think about TNA Impact Wrestling moving to Wednesday nights? And is that a good and smart move? He put it in all caps. For them. What do you also think about WWE SmackDown moving back to Thursday nights starting around October? Do you guys intend on watching the show on Thursday now as opposed to Fridays? Your thoughts on these guys? No, I'm not going to watch Impact or SmackDown.
If it's on Thursday, I may watch it because I'm sitting there on the computer.
Well, you watch Impact every week anyway.
I do.
Yeah, I don't watch either one.
I'm sitting there on the computer, so if Impact's on Wednesdays, SmackDown on Thursdays, so I'll check them out.
If I get paid to watch them, I'll watch.
Matt Johnson.
Oh, we're going to actually get through it. Wow. Okay.
Matt Johnson. A recent report came out saying Spike TV considers TNA a lame duck product. They also ran cops on TNA's old Thursday spot. Does it show what Spike truly feels about TNA? It's like they don't really give a shit about it.
They don't.
I mean, Spike TV wants out of the wrestling business, as we talked about earlier.
They don't give a shit about it.
You know, they extended it basically to be nice and give TNA enough time to find another network.
And I think they thought that the male demographic that they attracted to TNA would convert to Bellator, which they own. But they found out putting cops before Bellator instead
was a bigger lead-in.
Not so much a bigger lead-in, about the same lead-in, but it cost millions and millions less to buy a fucking season or two of old cops episodes.
You know what? No, let me bring up a quick point. You and I thought the same thing. Wrestling and MMA would kind of cross-promote each other. Same fan base. I think Spike TV felt that wrestling and Bellator... TNA and Bellator could kind of cross-promote each other. doesn't work that way. We're trying to grow an MMA site off a wrestling website right now. It ain't working. I've tried with my website.
It all depends on the anchor that that appeals to both. When I built MMAnews.com, Brock Lesnar hadn't even started his career. I started MMAnews.com in 2002.
So you had
and my big crossover guy was Ken Shamrock at the time. Why? He was many years removed from his WWE career.
Right.
But I figured he had a... And Tito Ortiz, if any wrestling fan knew of any MMA guy, and you got to think, back then, UFC, nobody knew
they
shit.
They would know a Shamrock Ortiz.
If they knew anybody in MMA, which was doubtful to UFC, it would be Tito Ortiz.
Right.
Which was even doubtful, but they would know Ken Shamrock. And maybe they would know about the storyline, because that was the first... They weren't even on cable. They weren't even on pay-per-view. I think they were on pay-per-view in minimal markets. You just brought up a very loaded question. But bottom line, as long as you got an anchor, a Ken Shamrock, a Brock Lesnar, somebody that care about,
wrestling fans,
you can lure wrestling fans over there, especially if they were at the age that we were at the time. I was at the time, I'm younger than you. If you're around 16, 17, and you're starting to grow out of wrestling, MMA is like the perfect transition, because the build-up to an MMA fight is the same as wrestling, as far as old school. Like, I hate you, here's why we're fighting, here's the day of the fight, and here's when it's happening.
Stand up, motherfucker.
And especially because it's real, you're going to pay to see that fight, because you're so invested in why they're fighting.
Absolutely.
Which is a lot of things they don't do right these days. Chael Sonnen fucking mastered it, but that's a very loaded question. I'll let you go ahead and go on.
You're next, man. It's,
where am I at?
What is it? It's a Nick Dodge.
Nick Dodge says, what do you think of the new WWE logo? It's
not
fucking
much of a change, right?
Not much.
It's not.
That's like asking, what do you think of the new WWE World Heavyweight title?
I know.
Same fucking
bit. All right, here's the last one from John Morgan.
We're not doing...
Vincent Nugent. All right, we'll take
one or the other.
One of the two.
So you pick one.
We've taken about four or five Nick.
You know you got to see more on this John Morgan, right?
Yes, we can do that.
All right, because it's probably going to be... Whoop.
Yeah, oh, it is.
All right.
Man.
While you're reading that, I'll pick one of these while you're reading
that. Yes, sir. John Morgan was going to call but decided to leave it the rapid fire. You guys mentioned Bree and Stephanie's promo during their feuds, but if you really go back and think about it, was Bree really what you'd call good in her part of it? No, she wasn't. And Nikki's been... Anyways, think about it. Stephanie came out, cut all of her promos fantastically. Granted, she's had like 10 years on the mic. And then every week with Brie, it was the same thing. You know what, Stephanie? Blah, 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 bitch. And the first time, the audience thought it was great. But then 3 weeks into it, pretty much 3 weeks into it, it was the same old thing from Brie, is what he's saying.
I didn't hear any of that because I was reading the other two things. I'll let you answer it, and then I'll go next.
I agree with you, man. Stephanie McMahon and Brie Bella, between that feud going into SummerSlam, Stephanie was the star of that feud. And it was
clearly,
like Brie.
Yeah.
It was like Brie was...
Brie was the hero of it. But.
Well, what John's saying is every week Brie would come out, blah, 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 Stephanie, you're a bitch. Blah, 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 blah. Stephanie, you're a bitch. Blah, blah, blah.
It's actually...
Same thing.
The other way around. Stephanie would blah, 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 and then Brie would off mic say, you're a bitch.
Right, but Stephanie was the star of that going into
it. Absolutely.
So Brie's never been good. What John's saying is even Brie has been... Okay, you're going to take Nikki Bella, Stephanie McMahon, and Brie Bella. Who's the weak link out of those three? Brie Bella's
and
the weak link.
And the proof in the pudding, like you said, is Stephanie was so good that all Brie had to do was react.
Right.
And it was only a quick one-liner here, like, oh, you're such a bitch. That one line was like, oh, Brie did great in her role last night. She had one line.
Yeah.
You know, and it felt real because it was real. Vincent Nugent, his first question, he says, should you guys consider dedicating a segment to Miss Jackie, who calls
we
in
love
her,
you, Jackie.
When she calls in about Rusev and Lana, or will most or all of the WCR Army riot about that portion?
So love Jackie.
Yeah, I think we should edit it that we give her too much. You love it so much that you give her so much time. I think it's a complete waste of time. I think we should let her call in and hear what she has to say. But after a question or two, the same as any other caller, we should get rid of her.
We love you, Jackie.
But no, I do love Jackie.
I love you.
His other questions, real quick. What do you guys think about the TNA Impact Wrestling shows from New York City so far? He thinks that they've been great, but he wants to know what we thought.
They've been very good.
I didn't
see
any of them.
I have seen them all,
I haven't seen one. He told me they're great, and he told me,
last couple
watch them, Boone, you're going to like them. I
last couple Thursdays, they've been great, and then last Wednesday, it was really good as well. So
feedback.
It was great. Feedback. We need your feedback tonight. Listen, we told you that in all of our number two, numero dos, we were going to take your rapid-fire questions, right?
Goddamn right
we ran a little bit late with Monday Night Raw and phone calls and everything else, right? We didn't start rapid-fire until about
30
9,
after?
9.30 40? Eastern time, right? We are now at almost 10.30 Eastern time.
Oh, I'm probably getting yelled at as we speak from my boss.
We still gave you a full hour of rapid fire tonight. We went overboard tonight. Matty Boone is getting yelled at by his boss because he doesn't have SmackDown spoilers up. Yes. I got to go get SmackDown
or
spoilers
main event
up.
Resolve.
And all the work and everything else that's going on tonight. It's going to be a late night because we went a little bit long with you guys tonight. So, we want your feedback. Both of our Facebook pages, Matt Boone, or Facebook.com/MattBooneWZR, Facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR, both of our pages. I'm going to put a feedback post up, Matt Boone is too, as soon as we go off the air here tonight. We want your feedback. Tell us what you liked about the show. Tell us what you didn't like about the show. Tell us what we should do better. Go to Facebook.com/
There, got the whole thing. Go ahead. You were very close. I give it my nod of approval. You did a good job.
All right, go to Facebook.com/MattBooneWZR, Facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR. That's Tuesday night, brother. We will see you guys next Tuesday night, 8 to 10 Eastern Time, WZROnline.com. Matt Boone, the Ryan Clark. See you next Tuesday, 8 to 10 Eastern Time, WZROnline.com.